Welcome to Anything Goes, the best geek and pop culture podcast broadcasting from Long Island, New York. I'm your host, Timothy Rooney. And just like the promise I made during the Jessica Jones podcast I did with Justin and Chris, I am here to do a Harry Potter podcast, and it's going to be a review of the first book, Harry Potter and the Philosopher's / Sorcerer's Stone, depending on which region in the world you have this book. And then this podcast may answer a few questions why I've been so Harry Potter centric for the past couple of weeks on Facebook and stuff like that. I've been questioned by some of my coworkers saying, why are you constantly quoting that? And I'm like, well, it's for a good purpose. I'm not just talking to myself here right now. I have two guests with me. Who is with me today?
Hi, Dakota Wiegen, like usual.
And I'm Nikki Torres, or Nikki Muggle, if you do Facebook.
If you do Facebook,
or any other social media.
That's what you'd be known as. And we are here to talk today about Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone, the book, not the movie. We may be doing the movie in the future. But everybody, get your copy of the book ready, and let's begin. Okay, now, since we've already swung the mic towards Nikki, why don't you answer the question first? I'm trying to cut down the swing of the microphone back and forth. It was funny because during the Jessica Jones podcast, I was listening back to it, and every now and then I hear whoosh, and I'm like, I hope nobody heard that, but apparently it did when I was listening back to it. Now, Nikki, when were you first introduced to this book series?
It was actually fifth grade. It was the prize in Mrs. Todd's class, and I wasn't a big reader. I actually really hated reading. And so I took the book to the beach every day in the summer. And
it took you several summers to get it
done. Yeah, it took it forever. It did take me the longest out of the entire series to finish. I was not about it. My mom was like, we're going to read it together. We're going to get through this. And it took me to like the final chapters to actually get into it. And then I was like, oh man, I need to know more. And that's how Nikki Muggle was born.
I guess your mom probably regretted it ever since.
Absolutely. After every Harry Potter merchandising item was required purchases, she was over it.
And Dakota?
So I was introduced to the series about the same time, fourth or fifth grade. I think it was more fifth grade. I wasn't into reading. I still struggle with reading a lot,
Which surprises me because every now and then, like he's like, "Oh, I finished it." You fly through things really quickly.
It depends on how much I like it.
Okay,
but I do struggle with this. Don't make me read anything out loud. You'll be here forever.
Okay,
but fifth grade, I was in Mrs. Stream's class, and I've heard of the book. I tried reading the book as a kid, didn't like it, but Mrs. Stream's class had the audio tapes on cassette, and she had, like, after, like, class, like, for, like, 20 minutes, you could do whatever the hell you wanted in the class. And I was on the audio players with the big 1970s headsets that lost the foam. So it's, like, ripping into your ears. But I'm listening to Jim Dale read the Harry Potter books. And I'm going, I like this.
So then, do you associate pain and anguish to your ears with Harry Potter from now on?
It sometimes comes back to mind. Depends on if it's a rough point or not. But after that, my parents were like, oh, he is actually enjoying a book. Mm-hmm. So they went out and actually continued to buy each book on the cassette tapes.
Right.
And then usually my brother and I would end up falling asleep to the cassette tapes, and then when we had to go back to re-listen to a part, we rewind it and then play from where we are and then pass out wherever.
Right. And how I first got introduced to this, it may have been like, remember elementary schools had book sale days, Scholastic, like, publishing would have like all different books set up on different racks, so you can say like, oh, I want this book and this book. And I'm pretty sure, I think that was one of the books I picked up, and I think my sister recommended it to me. And because she had already read it at that point, and she was already a few books into the series, my sister Stephanie. And so I think one, it was like kind of like you, I was not the greatest reader in the world, or it's something like, because I had learning classes with, to help me with my reading and writing. So it was like one of those things that like I enjoyed reading. So of course, like our parents is like, of course, our kid wants to read. Like, and it seems like the case for all three of us, shepherded that and then just became one of those things that I ended up reading this. And then right after that, reading Chamber of Secrets. And then I think right after Chamber of Secrets, I read like the first movie came out. Mm-hmm. And then it's one of those weird things. I read book one and two, did not read three. And then picked up with Goblet of Fire. I do not know why I did not read Prisoner of Azkaban up until recently when I listened to the audiobooks at work.
You should have been pistol whipped right on the spot.
Well,
you missed a huge chunk of the story.
Yes, and well, being a ginger to begin with, I was being pistol whipped daily anyway. Yeah, so, like, by even strangers, I was just getting accustomed to it. So it wouldn't have been that different for me. Now, Dakota, can you give a brief synopsis on the book Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone?
Okay. That was how you love to pin this on me when we do stuff.
Well, the microphone's already facing you. Do you want to ask Nikki?
No, I got it. I'll take this. All right. So it follows the book follows a boy named Harry Potter.
You don't say.
Oh my God! It's a shocker.
Plot twist.
But Harry Potter is a orphan child who lives with his aunt, uncle, and cousin who are the worst people literally on the face of the earth. And when he turns 11, he finds out that he is a wizard, and not only a wizard, but a famous wizard who axed off the most evilest of evil people ever. And then he had no idea because he was a baby. Mm-hmm. So nobody still really understands except the Dumbledore, the headmaster of Hogwarts, he has a guess, but that's later on.
Right.
So he goes to Hogwarts, does all these shenanigans, finds out more about wizarding, and realizes, holy shit, This is not just saying hocus pocus. And then the Dark Lord decides, hey, I'm coming back. Why? Because there's something in this castle that can regenerate him back to his old self. And then some shit happens.
Oh my God, there's a Brock out there.
Oh my God.
Mark Wahlberg's like, oh my God.
The trees are moving. Guys, we gotta love each other.
Sorry about that. I had a look. Is how he's describing it. I'm just like,
what?
No! Still taking to Mark Wahlberg there. Nikki's immediately regretting doing this right now.
Why did I say we would do this?
Exactly. Just like, what lie can I do to get out of this right now?
Some shit goes down. Harry saves the stupid stone that's all immortal life just to have it destroyed by Dumbledore. And that's
Nicholas Flamel.
And yeah.
Now,
why didn't it just have been easier to say, hey, Nick, you're gonna die? It's just the easiest way. Okay, Dumbledore, whatever you say.
Just like that.
Book would have been a lot easier. Harry would have had a very successful first year.
Now, where would the conflict of that story be? So, of course, Nicholas Flamel was a little selfish. So the guy who, the alchemist that made the Sorcerer's Stone in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
And then I was like, we wouldn't have a story that way.
No, this is true.
I know, you're just being really nitpicky.
I'm just being a bitch about it, but yes.
About a myriad of things as well, so it's okay.
Okay. I will accept this.
Okay. Now, let's start with the titular character of this book series, and I'll ask Nikki, what are your feelings on Harry Potter in this first book after rereading it, like you said recently?
The thing about Harry is just how innocent he is, and I think you lose that going on in the series, especially mm-hmm. you hit Order of the Phoenix, and Harry is just the most angsty, like, annoying person in the world. So when you
I'm
get
so
like,
angry all the time,
yeah, just yelling at everything and anything. So when you get like this really innocent, like, I don't know what Quidditch is, is a sorting hat where we take a rabbit out of it. Like, he just doesn't get what's going on, and then he just gets thrown into it, and you start to see the little bits of bravery, you start to see everything that you start to love about Harry come into life in the first book. That's what I got on that.
His innocence is also a great way for exposition, because as the reader, we have no idea what the hell's going on, but neither does Harry, so the way they explain everything is like a small, stupid child being explained everything. So it makes sense to the reader, makes sense to Harry.
Because he's the alien to the world
at that point. Yeah, he's the alien to the world, and it works for the reader because there's still situations where you're going like, what? And Harry's going like, I don't know what's going on.
That's like one of those things that would, you figure it'd become less and less prevalent throughout the rest of the books, but even up until Deathly Hallows, he's still being explained things.
Yeah, like, because these are things that he was thrown into this culture at an age where it's like, all right, he's already used to normal people life.
Right.
He's thrown into this new culture where everyone grows up with these things, so it's second nature to them, and he's still struggling with, like, oh my god, what do you do around a goblin?
Mm-hmm. And your feelings, like, other than that, do you feel like, what are your feelings on that, other than the it being really easy for exposition for him? What are your feelings on
that? I mean, the Harry Potter in the first book is really enjoyable because it's that total wide-eye deer in the headlights situation going, but you can also feel his frustrations when there is frustrating moments, but you also feel like his excitement, you also feel his curiosity, so it's a great way to connect to the reader itself. So I think he's great in the first book,
which I agree, and it's like one of those things that, as you guys both highlighted, he's so innocent and so unassuming that he just, like, the first time when he deals with a wizarding public that realizes, oh, this is Harry Potter, and everybody's like, thank you for what you've done. And he's like, he has absolutely no idea what has happened. He's like, he has been told in the previous chapter that what he did to Voldemort. And he's just like, oh, no problem. And he's shaking the hands for people for like 10 minutes. And then he eventually goes down to Diagon Alley. Now, if that was like Harry Potter from like book 5 on, where he'd be like, no, don't touch me. And just be a little bit really petulant about that. We're hating on later Harry Potter. We haven't gotten there yet.
Piss off, asshole!
All the negative feelings are just coming out now. We're just going to have no ammunition later.
Just beating this poor 11-year-old Harry Potter to death.
And that he's really selfish, like the fact that, or like really in tune to at least when he's dealing with other people, because he's lived on eggshells for so long, dealing with the Dursleys and stuff like that, and recognizing human behavior, like the moment where he's on the train with Ron, and he realizes that Ron's family is not the richest family in the world, and he really notices that right off the bat. He doesn't pull like a Malfoy and just make fun of him because he doesn't come from means, and he actually helps him, but he doesn't really call attention to it. He's not going to be like, oh, I'll help you because I know you're not doing that well financially. He's not going to be that kind of kid. He's just going to be like, so what's... And it's a point that's brought up in Chamber of Secrets when he goes to the Burrow for the first time and Ron's really nervous of showing him his room because it's a kind of a cramped house. And he's like, I love it just because of the way it is.
There was also shooting ahead to the Chamber of Secrets as well when they went to Gringotts Bank. Harry's at his vault trying to hurriedly shovel money into his wallet without, like,
everybody gawking at
how much cash he has.
Right.
Yeah, so, I mean...
And he doesn't want
to... But they say in the first book that it's like Harry, when Harry saw all the gold in his vault, it's like he was never given pocket money, so he has no idea what it's like to have money. And it was like one of those things was like, when he meets Ron, it's like, well, I never had money. You don't have money. Why don't we share money?
Yeah, exactly.
And I'll buy the entire tray of candy.
Yeah, pretty much the entire, like, trolley of everything that they have
on
there.
You just bought everyone's food, you prick.
Not even old Harry Potter escapes, even young in the first book as he kisses. Dakota just had like a little bit of Sweep of Halsey moment right there. I'm sorry.
Sorry.
I will not call attention to it anymore. Since we brought him up, let's talk about Ron and our feelings of Ron in this first story.
Oh, we're starting with me.
I have the mic too much.
Yeah, you know what? I really like Ron. I feel like Ron will always be that underdog character, even before, you know, Harry really starts to shine as the chosen one. And so when you first meet Ron just kind of seems like down. Like, it doesn't matter what I do because, you know, I got an older brother who trains dragons. I got an older brother that's this. You know, the other one's doing that. Everybody loves, you know, the twins. Who doesn't love the twins? You really just have to love the twins.
You can't. Only heartless people don't like the twins.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. They're just... So, like, you know, he's coming in and he's just got some really, really big shoes to fill. And you just feel for him. And I like that... From the moment that Harry's on the platform, having no freaking idea how to get to this train, you know, he just forms a connection. And I do find that without Ron, you couldn't have Harry. Ron is the balancing force. Ron is that, basically that olive tree branch into the wizarding world for Harry.
That's a really nice way to put it and everything like that, as they slowly squeak the mic back to Dakota, as I'm starting to fall apart now. Wow. it's just spreading like a disease at this point.
Yeah, soon Nikki's going to be drawing it
out too. We really like this book. Your feelings are Ron in this first book.
I think Nikki nailed it on the head. He's just, he's an enjoyable character. You just can't help but feel sorry for him in a lot of situations. I mean, they do make it very, I mean, you have to credit J.K. Rowling for such incredible writing of, like, feeling like, holy crap, this kid is has some big shoes to fill because every brother ahead of him has done something memorable. I mean, the twins, I'm not sure if it's worth remembering some of the stuff that they've done.
No,
but,
it definitely is.
Well, no, but in the views of their parents, like, because of how they joke around and they get in trouble all the time. But,
which I feel like their father kind of...
He supports it, but in front of Molly...
Yeah, he doesn't really.
Not really.
I mean, that's why I think one of my favorite moments from the movie of Chamber of Secrets is when Molly explains, like, your son's, like...
Your sons were flying that flying car of yours. Really?
How did
it
go?
I mean, that was very wrong, boys. Very wrong indeed.
But he's obviously just like, he's a total, like, other child, another brother to that family when it comes to that. And at least with the twins and that. But go on, what you were saying about Ron.
I forget the name of the mirror.
Oh.
Mirror of,
I can spell it.
I want to say, it's not...
You guys can look it up. I'm just
mirror of a... It's something... Does it start with an A?
Mirror of A...
No. Look at the back of the last chapters. They mention it when Quirrell's looking at it. But even when Harry finds that giant mirror, he brings Ron to check it out to show Harry, to show Ron all of his family. And Ron doesn't see Harry's family. He sees him being everything that his brothers were. Head of the Quidditch team.
Erised? E-R-I-S-E-D.
Damn it.
Desired.
Backwards.
Oh.
Because it's mirror and that.
Wow. I'm dumb.
I'm just going to pack up my things right now. All my writings of subtext. And
okay.
And
we couldn't figure it out.
The mirror of desire.
I never put one and one together, but okay. I thought it was something elvish or something like that. I don't know, like something out of Lord of the Rings.
No, there's plenty of other ripoffs of Lord of the Rings and Harry Potter series. I'm not going to go with that right now.
But I have to contribute to J.K. Rowling's writing on Ron because it's very, very great character, and it is a very good bridge to the wizarding world for Harry.
And what I feel like with Ron is that, like you're saying, like all of his, like, Charlie, like, is doing with dragons. Bill's in Africa and stuff like that. We're doing something for Gringotts. Percy's a prefect. Fred and George are the troublemakers, but everybody loves him at school.
Mm-hmm.
And schoolwork is so easy for them. And he's not the youngest either, because Ginny's the youngest. So he's the perfect middle child there.
Yes, and Ginny has a pass already because she's the only girl.
Yeah, so he's screwed on many fronts right there.
Yes.
But... He tries not to let that get to him as much as possible, and I think that's why I like whenever Fred and George tease him, he's like, no, it doesn't bother me, and tries to brush it off, but it's like such a I'm okay, I'm sad, why does everybody love me as much as me? And like, even to the point where his mom made sandwiches for him for the train ride to Hogwarts, and he's kind of embarrassed of it because she always messes up his sandwich because he doesn't like roast beef.
I don't like roast beef. No, I don't like corned beef.
Corned beef. And as a ginger saying corn, he doesn't like corned beef, I'm surprised. Like, a leprechaun just pop out and shank him right there at that point.
Well, one thing that it kind of gets very overlooked, I know I hop it ahead to Chamber of Secrets, but Harry and Ron do receive plaques for services to the school at the end of it. And that's something I'm pretty sure none of the Weasleys had done.
No.
That's something I feel gets overlooked all the time.
Now, was that plaque in the room of...
The trophy room.
The trophy room?
Yeah, it's the same thing, like, if you read through the book, Ron was cleaning Tom Riddle's shield.
Yes.
And that's services to the school, awarded for services to school. Right. They have, Harry and Ron have exact the same thing.
Right, probably next to Riddle's, yes. Stuff like that. Okay.
Just something to throw out there where it's like, he did something that his other brothers didn't do.
Yes.
So, and suck it.
So he may not be, yeah. I have a plaque, Mom. I'm can I get gonna... that plaque into a job? No.
I didn't want to steal a mic on that.
I'm talking way
but
too much.
You know what? You're totally right, because I didn't even really think about that. There are a lot of things that Ron does that he never gets noticed for, and I do think he really is the middle child, and he, theoretically, you look at it, he's not actually the middle child when you look at
how the lineage
breakdown is. And he should, by being the youngest boy, be spoiled too, but he's not. And it's almost like everything, I don't even want to say average because I feel it's demeaning to what he does in the whole series, but every average character that a person has who's reading it, you can see that in Ron. Like, Ron's well enough liked. He's not, you know, super popular like the twins. You know, he's athletic enough. I mean, he ends up doing very well in Quidditch.
Yes.
And, you know, he is brave enough, so he really has these qualities that all his siblings have. I mean, even the spunkiness that you see in Ginny, it's present in Ron, so he does. He's probably the most understated character.
Do you think he overcompensates because of that?
Oh, absolutely. And I think the fact that he's trying to outshine not only his family, but his best friend. And I don't think you do see him resent Harry at one point, but I don't think it was a very authentic resentment. I do think more it was, he just hated that everybody gets, you know, you look at Hermione, who's so freaking smart, and, you know, you get Harry, who's so freaking brave, and he's just right there in the middle, like he always
is. What am I,
is.
The muscle? Kind of like, yeah. Of that situation right there.
Well, I mean, everything that we're talking about goes well into the series.
Yeah,
but everything that we did mention, he doesn't see in himself.
Mm-hmm.
That's why he still overtries. Like in Quidditch, he overthinks everything to the point where his overthinking is messing him up to the point where he's like, I'm horrible, and like your performance is horrible.
Mm-hmm.
So, but meanwhile, there's actual talent there. He just doesn't. He just has to go with it and not overthink it. I mean, a lot of stuff that he does is overthinking, and he does kind of do it to himself, which I can relate because I'm a middle child, and I do overthink all the time.
Right.
And that messes with me, so.
And it's just like one of the things you got to take into effect that, like, what if you were best friends with the president or something like that? Like, your best friend, who you've known since childhood, happens to be, like, the most powerful person on the earth, and then you're just the guy next to him, and you're just like, and I'm always with you, yet I'm not treated it as such. I'm always saying like, oh, you're his friend, you're not your own person. He seems like your own identity is defined by the person next to you.
It's like a Beyonce with Kelly and Michelle. Like, you look at Destiny's Child and,
ooh, good pull there.
Harry is the Beyonce and yeah. Ron is the Michelle.
I love how you made the decision.
We'll give Hermione Kelly because Kelly did some stuff, but poor Michelle, she got slept on, and that's what happens to Ron. Ron gets slept on.
Well, I just popped in my mind. If you guys ever seen Avatar: The Last Airbender, the whole thing with Avatar Roku, the Firebender Avatar, he's best friends with the Fire Lord.
Right.
And on the day, he's best friends with the Fire Lord. They knew the guy was going to be the Fire Lord, and then all of a sudden, Roku is the Avatar, and then the Fire Lord's like, oh, well, you were best friends with the Avatar. It's like, yes, you're important, but you're not important enough.
Right. And it's just like one of those things that you kind of like, and something that's obviously brought up later on, but at least in this book, it doesn't call too much attention of it. Now let's move on to the third person of this trio of misfits that roam Hogwarts grounds, Hermione Granger. Your feelings on her?
You know, first book, Hermione is very annoying, and I will give her that. That is, like, you know, I feel bad because you end up, you just really are endeared by Hermione as time goes on, and you, even in the movies, you can't help but love Emma Watson, but Hermione in the first book is, and I think that's an overcompensation because she's a muggle-born, and she just wants to prove herself, so, and you can't deny the girl's brilliant, and it's just, you know, she's the one with those messed up priorities, not the boys.
That's true. I'll give you that.
You have debt. on your nose. Do you know that?
After like that's like the seventh person who has reminded Ron at that point that he has dirt on his nose. He is yet to clean it. That point, he deserves to go.
Oh, you're doing magic. Let's see then. Oh, that's not really a real spell. Here, I've been practicing in the off days. Let's see. The panel! Boo! It's all done. Oh my gosh, you're Harry Potter. I read all about you. Oh, you have dirt on your nose. Okay, bye-bye. That's how you introduce Hermione Granger, and she's such a bitch.
I was going to say, tell me how you really feel.
But, I mean, after... But that's the character all the way up until the troll scene. When the troll breaks in.
Yes.
And Ron and Harry actually save Hermione from the troll, and then she becomes so much better.
True, but then you could argue the fact she wouldn't have been there if it wasn't for the douchiness of Ron right there, and that's in the previous chapter.
True, but...
However, it was predicated on the fact that she was a Ms. Know-It-All at the time.
It's you could argue with most things, Hermione, that she wouldn't have been there if it wasn't for the douchiness of Ron. Like, I feel like that just goes for
how many situations you could probably round off right there.
You know, and it's funny when you think about it, because she only knew Harry from reading about Harry Potter. So she really doesn't know the significance of the wizarding world except for what she knows in books, which is why I think up into that troll scene you find her so annoying. It's because it's one of those people that are so book smart, but they have no street smarts. And there's no practical application to that.
I know a few people like that.
Yeah, and so it's fun to watch Hermione progress as a character, because she starts to realize, hey, I can probably be a human and not just a walking encyclopedia.
I just had like a clarity clearance moment.
Yeah, an epiphany?
What?
An epiphany?
Yeah. Harry was taken from his house after the explosions and Voldemort disappearing everything, and Hagrid got there, took him on Dumbledore's orders to be left at his aunt's house. How does the wizarding world know that Harry Potter has a lightning scar on his forehead?
Dumbledore got smashed in the celebration and blabbered at somebody.
The kid has a lightning bolt on his head! Oh my god, it's atrocious! Ow.
Good. You deserve it.
What if I'm making fun of you for falling apart a few minutes ago?
You know what? I don't think they actually knew it was a lightning bolt. I think they just think it's a scar. And because the only one who could have really spilled the beans on that would be Hagrid when he's drinking at the Leaky Cauldron.
Hagrid has been known to spill the beans a lot.
Yes. He's got a bit of a drinking problem, which I've realized throughout these books. I'm like, he's a mild alcoholic. And he drinks his sorrows away.
Well, the first thing is he kept slipping me drinks. And then he started asking me what animals I take care of. And I told him about Fluffy.
You asked about Fluffy?
Of course he was interested in Fluffy. It's a three-headed dog. How many can you run into?
And then he blushed. He said, not that Fluffy. And I ended up in bed with the person.
One thing led to another. He came over to my place for
drinks. Gave me his dragon, and then he showed me
his pet dragon, and I stroked it.
It's fun, because I was rereading at the bar today where I work, and...
Ironically, of all places.
I know, isn't that hysterical? So I'm reading it, and I was just like, oh, man. So Hagrid had a bad day, and his first thought is, hey, Harry, do you mind if I drop you off in this strange place and go get a few rounds to feel better?
What's Tom's first lines to Hagrid? Ah, Hagrid, usual, I presume.
And then you,
my
like,
God, man.
I'm surprised he didn't just, like, ask, just start, like, stealing it for him like that. And, okay, but now I realize one thing about Lightning Scar and everything, the events that happened that night. So, in the first book, we mentioned that Sirius Black let Hagrid borrow the motorcycle to get him from the Potter house to Privet Drive. Now, in later books, we find out that Snape was there. He was, like, one of the first people to see. He and mourned Lily after the attack. So, Hagrid must have been there. Snape must have been there. Maybe Sirius must have been on the case trying to find out where Peter Pettigrew was. I'm like, was it like a revolving door of everybody, like, and just left
Wait,
the Potter?
Snape was there? I thought he found out. I don't think.
Unless
read it.
No, I'm pretty sure he was there. I'm pretty sure.
I thought
the minute he had.
I thought he found out through the grapevine that happened, and then he was like, "But he promised not to kill her."
It might be one of those like.
I know in the movie they show a scene with Alan Rickman, like, embracing Lily after, and like Harry's in the background, like in his crib, like knocked over and stuff like that, right after he died. And I'm like, that may have been like a convenience change to the movie. It's been a while since I've read Deathly Hallows.
So I have to reread Deathly Hallows. I need to reread that.
Yes. Yeah, we'll put it in that. We'll come
back.
We are
going to address this 6 books from now.
Yeah. And other than her snootiness, well, how do you feel about Hermione overall throughout the rest of the book?
I do like Hermione. I mean, without Hermione, nothing would have happened.
Right.
I mean, Ron and Harry would be pretty much sitting in their own shit, wondering, like, I wonder what Snape's going to do with the stone. I don't know, but it must not be good. Oh, bother. And then you just have Quirrell just standing in front of the mirror going, how the fuck do I get to it? It just stands there. I mean,
for eons and eons.
Until Dumbledore's like, the yeah. fuck you doing?
It's Eddie Gibbs, like Shadow Heads, for eons and eons.
Oh, God. But and, no, but if it wasn't Hermione, they wouldn't. The plot, I mean, she moves the plot along. She is the brains behind the operation.
Totally.
I mean, Harry executes everything. The three of them come up with a plan. Hermione brings up the plan on how to do X, Y, and Z.
Right.
Ron's there for comic relief sometimes, but he's also there to push everyone along.
Yes.
So, but Hermione's a key component to this.
And I love the fact with all three characters that they, like, as we've all said, that they've all bring their own individual skills to the table when it comes to dealing with all these situations. Case in point, at the end, like, Hermione knowing everything about her biology, that's why they get through the devil's snare. Harry's skills in the broom, that's why he's able to get the key fairy thing from the sky, from the ceiling.
Which I think the movie enhances the key part a little bit better, because in the book, it's just the keys are just flying, even right. when they touch the broom.
So. Mm-hmm.
It's not much of a challenge if you really think about it for Harry, because like, oh, I'm a seeker, grab the key.
Right.
But in the movie, they actually make it, I mean, I know we're not talking about the movie, but in the movie, they actually make it really difficult for him because the keys are attacking him while the main key, the key that unlocks doors, flying away.
Right. And it's been so long since I've seen the movie, I totally forgot about it. I thought they omitted that part of it from the movie.
They omitted
the potions.
The potions and him discovering the troll.
Yes. And then you have like them on her, him and the broom, then obviously Ron with the chessboard and everything like that, and Hermione with the potions. And with Hermione, like as we've all said, that she's a little bit snooty in the first half of it, but it's also like you said, one of those people who just like, she's trying so hard to fit in and reading so much to make herself the most educated person in the room, to the point that it gets on some people's nerves. Most of the characters gets, especially Severus Snape, who just can't stand the fact that she tries to be a know-it-all and like immediately tries to beat her down because of it throughout the books, especially in Prisoner of Azkaban. I was listening to the part when he like finally snaps at her, just like, just shut up for once. And
5 points from Gryffindor for being a know-it-all.
Ka-kling.
That's an actual line.
Yeah, I know. I mean, you should, like, it's been a drinking game how many times Snape took
there
that.
Is a drinking game.
I can only imagine what the drinking game
I
is
mean,
like.
Every time Harry asks a question about the Wizarding World,
oh,
every
God.
Time points are awarded to Gryffindor, every time points are lost for Gryffindor, every time someone says Harry.
Oh, no.
Where did I see that?
It's kind of like the air. It's kind
it
of like
probably
the,
was on Facebook. I think I, it might
it
have been
might
you.
It might have been mine because my cousin posted it. Hold on, I'm trying to pull it up right now. But yeah, it's like every time Harry's scar hurts, you take a drink, and those are games I try not to play because those are the games that you don't remember your name after. But yeah, no, it was.
It's kind of like when I was up at school, three friends decided to play the airplane drinking game. And one of the rules is every time there's an airplane scene, and so like there's in every scene, there's always like a picture of an airplane in the background or somebody mentions a plane. And then at one point, I think like an hour into the movie, I go down the hall, go to the bathroom, and I'm coming back, and it's kind of quiet in the dorm room. And they're like, just, plane! A few more steps, blame the whole crowd. I'm like, Jesus Christ, the RA is going to bust this for this because most of you are not 21 right now.
Ooh, I got it. Harry Potter drinking game. Every time you drink, every time Harry's scar hurt, Ron does something wrong. Malfoy mentions his father. Hagrid says, I shouldn't have said that. Anyone is awarded points. Points are taken away. Someone shouts, Harry! Hermione raises her hand. Ron says, bloody. Snape says something offensive. And Voldemort's name is avoided with that good old you-know-who. If you're playing the drinking game along with us.
Well,
oh, bloody hell!
Well, you-know-who about Severus Snape making something snooty. Anyway, so let's move on with them. Let's stick with all of the people that's on the good side of the wizarding world. Let's go to Professor McGonagall.
Oh, my fave. I love Professor McGonagall. You know what? There's something to be said about someone who is stern, who follows rules, yet is still likable.
Yes.
She's just one of those forces that I honestly don't think Hogwarts would have ran so smoothly under Dumbledore without her. I think she's that voice of reasoning for his eccentricity. Is that a real word, or did I just make that up?
It's close
enough to a real word.
My pronunciation is failing me right now.
I know, hooked on phonics and me didn't go along. Yeah.
Goofy click
craziness. Like, Oddwood, yeah. Timble, mumbles.
He's not very eccentric.
And she's a very together kind of woman. And I don't think you get more badass than Professor McGonagall.
No, I agree. I mean, Professor McGonagall, even though sometimes like, oh my God, you're so stiff. You have to love her.
That's when you rolled over and she was on top, right?
Speaking of which, they never mention that she's an old witch.
No.
They actually say she has dark black hair and it's in a very tight bun. So
they cast an old woman for it.
Maggie Smith was amazing. Oh, yeah. I'm never going to say anything bad about that role.
Oh, no.
But in the Harry Potter series, you can technically replace her with some hot librarian witch.
Is that so that's how you fell asleep to those audio cassettes then? That's all I'm going to say.
Yeah. What am I getting detention with you, Professor McGonagall?
Your brother just rolls over. Why are you rewinding that again? Shh, don't worry about it. This is getting more inappropriate as it goes.
It really is.
No,
somebody's gonna send like a really strongly worded email. Like, I was listening to this with my family, and like, and it got really inappropriate really quickly.
J.K. Rowling responds to the man named Mr. Dakota Wygan. Professor McGonagall was casted appropriately as Maggie Smith. You dumb, dirty bastard!
And
you should be ashamed of yourselves. Make sure that your eyes are not bleeding out of your face.
Move along.
All right, but yes, no, Professor McGonagall was an awesome character. She's so enjoyable throughout the series.
Mm-hmm.
And you could tell, I mean, there's scenes throughout the series where she does really care for Harry because she knows exactly what he's going through at home.
Yeah, but it's also one of those things that she doesn't forget the fact that she's a teacher first and foremost.
Yes.
And like, even this, like, despite like all the things that could probably be going on, like the fact that they know about the Sorcerer's Stone, they confront her about it, like who's going to steal and stuff like that. She's like, I know all the things that they're there to prepare to prevent people from getting it, and accusing another teacher is not a good thing, but I'm going to overlook it because you're in my house and I enjoy you two being in my house. But the fact that, like, as we were saying, that she's willing to be stern and not be like one of those, like many of the teachers later on in the series who are really stern and are really stick to the rules end up becoming like the most hated people in those books. Professor Umbridge being numero uno right there.
Well, I wouldn't classify her as extremely stern. She was extremely psychotic.
Yes.
But that's for a different review.
Yes. And one of the things that I really enjoy the fact is that her introduction, even though we don't know it's her yet, with Mr. Dursley going off to work and he sees her as a cat reading a map.
Reading a map.
And he does a double take and she immediately puts it away and just sits there. It's like, nothing to see here. Move along. Nobody noticed me.
Yeah, well, I love Dumbledore. It's like the little thing when they introduce Professor McGonagall as the cat.
Yeah.
Turning into the, like, nice to see you here, Professor McGonagall. How did you know it was me? Dear Professor, I have never seen a cat sit so stiffly on a wall before.
And then she immediately transforms, and then...
It's like one of those things where it's like, yeah, she would be a very stiff cat.
And just sit there all day waiting for his arrival.
Very prim and proper.
Since we mentioned the headmaster, let's start with him.
Back to me. Okay. It's so hard to describe because...
Try to keep it in the context of the first book.
And that's what that's what I was just about to say. It's really hard to take it just in the context of the first book because with Dumbledore, he's such a large character in between all the books. It's just really hard to separate them. But as far as the first one, I think he is the best kind of grandfathery figure that Harry has never been accustomed to. He's used to these really... awful family figures, and here comes this gentle, wise old man who has taken kind of a special liking to him, and he is odd. Like I said earlier, he's just a very odd guy, and at the same time, he's a very brilliant guy, so he walks that very fine line of genius and madness.
And it's kind of like if you put like Einstein and Santa Claus together, that's pretty much what you get.
Yeah, no, he's definitely the lovable grandfather figure who's a little crazy, but you ultimately enjoy him.
Right.
But I have to go back to the way J.K. Rowling described him in the book. It is so perfect because she describes him as like the blue twinkle in his eye, but the nose that looks like it was
broken twice,
several times, and just how much experience and age you could just. He just admits, but he's at the same time, he's also one of those people that you have to love him and respect him.
Yes.
Because he's just that person.
Right.
It is really hard just to put him in the context of the first book because...
He becomes so much more defined as the books go.
He becomes so much more defined, and at the same time, you kind of lose, like... He's done some shit. And I'm saying that in the most serious way. As you read the books, he's done some shit. And it does take away from the perfect...
Smooth criminal.
Takes away from the how perfect he is. But he ultimately... But sticking to the first book, he's a very likable character when you do read about him.
Right. And I love the fact that... And like in one of the earliest ways of it, when we first see him, when he clicks out all the lights, all the street lights on Privet Drive, and then Professor McGonagall questions him about why everybody's celebrating, he's kind of just like... Let them celebrate. We've been living in this terror for so many years right now. So what if we're going to be a little noisy to the Muggle world? They'll get over it. That's why we have a Ministry of Magic in the first place. Mm-hmm. But he's so trusting of people around him, even so much to the fact that he let Hagrid fly Harry on a motorcycle, not by broomstick or anything like else, to get there.
My dear Professor McGonagall, I trust Hagrid with my life.
Holy crap! The fuck, Hagrid? I trust you with one thing and you fuck it up, you bastard.
I'm just imagining like Hagrid in a giant Evel Knievel costume right now as he lands. But it's like too tight for him too. It's like a little small. Oh, man. And then later on in the book that he... Like, it shows that, like, he, especially when Harry's being sorted into the Gryffindor house, that he sits up and takes notice. Of course, he gives his attention to every first year that's going to be sorted there, but he obviously raises an eyebrow, like, which house is he going to go into? Because like, he said, like, well, could he be like his father or could he be like somebody else? He doesn't really know because he hasn't spent that much time with him as he grew up.
Yeah, which that gets explained a little bit further on in the series where it's like, okay, well, especially, what was it, in the fifth or sixth book where Dumbledore refuses to make eye contact with him?
Yeah, he separates himself really hard in the sixth book, and it's for a reason. You could argue how effective or how... Yeah, smart. Well, the reason is, but we're not on that book yet.
Yeah, but yeah, no, it was you. Yeah, he does pay extra close attention to Harry when he gets sorted,
which makes you like I kind of feel bad for everybody else, like in Hufflepuff and Ravenclaw, because they're like of other
feel bad for Hufflepuff,
like just like those two houses, just like you know.
But I don't actually think anyone noticed that because everybody wanted to know where Harry was going, so everybody was invested in. Obviously, we know Dumbledore was a lot more invested in Harry's future and what's going on, because he was a lot more privy to information than Susan Bones was, you know? Like,
true.
So I don't think anybody was like, oh my gosh, Dumbledore's playing favorites. That particular moment, I mean, it does come along, but yeah, like
especially
I don't
the movie
think
adaptation, it really shows like,
oh yeah. And you know, and that's it. Dumbledore paying more attention. I mean, you could also, so was Snape, so was McGonagall, so everybody down to the twins wanted to know where the boy who lived was going to be sorted.
Right. And the thing is, like, the thing I love about Dumbledore, especially when in the first book, is when Harry discovers the mirror, and that he respects that Harry's curiosity and has the tendencies of his father to break rules and explore the school, because he kind of expected Harry to explore the school because he's never been part of the wizarding world and never been in a good home. But he's really stern with him. He's saying, like, this mirror is going to be moved from this location and do not come looking for it again, because he knows that it's not going to be good for him. It's going to become an addiction just to experience that, what, trying to have that life a little bit. And that's even something that's brought up in the third book even more during the Dementors, just to hear his parents' voice. That's why Harry, it seems like he messes up a little bit just to hear his mom's voice and his dad's voice. Anyway, let's go down the rest of the staff of Hogwarts School Wizardry. Let's go with Hagrid himself, since we've kind of taken jabs at him thus far. Start with you, Dakota. Your feeling?
We've taken jabs at him, but you cannot hate Hagrid.
No,
he is one. He's actually extremely old, but they never addressed that. If you
no,
really think about it. He was expelled 50 years ago, and he still looks like he's like in his 40s, 40s.
Mm-hmm.
So that has to be the giant in him, but. But yeah, no, he's Hogwarts gameskeeper, so he takes care of the property plus all the animals that encompass the property and the Forbidden Forest. He loves all the magical creatures, as you could tell. He just goes out of his way to get whatever interests him, and the more dangerous it is, the more he loves it.
Right. And he scratches his head at people who don't realize
he doesn't
that.
Understand it, but also he's very stubborn, because like when they get Norbert the dragon, and dragons growing up in his house and starting to really get aggressive, he's really trying to control the dragon to the point where he's like I you guys need to go, because he's in a very weird stage right now. He's biting people, he's blowing flames everywhere, but he's adorable. Look at him.
And Game of Thrones character he is not, so that's why he cannot control a dragon.
No, he's not. Well,
if I knew her character's name, I'd say it.
Yes. Daenerys?
Daenerys, yeah.
Since I swung the mic to you, Nikki, you're feeling some Hagrid?
Well, yeah, I mean, I agree. Like, he's just, like, a lovable oaf, and, like, I just really love how she describes him. Like, the first thing you hear, he's, like, he's almost too large to be allowed, and he's just this wild figure. And he really is just, like, a merry giant. And yeah, he's got a little bit of an alcohol problem, like we touched on, and he's got a little bit of a gabby mouth. But I think the reason he likes the exotic creature so much is that he himself is part exotic creature.
Yes.
You know, and you could see that later on with Umbridge. But I think that he kind of is the perfect guardian, that like fun uncle for the trio to go to. They all have that kind of relationship with him. It's not just Harry. I don't think Harry's relationship's any stronger than, you know, Hermione's and Hagrid's and Ron and Hagrid's. I just think that Hagrid takes to, he's almost like the island of misfit toys in a character. He just takes to those people that need a home.
And it's one of those, like, the strong points that, like, if the trio doesn't have nobody to talk to about a certain situation, whether it be emotional or plot driven, they go to Hagrid to talk about it, and he is always willing to listen, unless the story is otherwise that he's not available at that moment. And like you're saying, that he's a great big oaf, and he's like, he doesn't, especially he takes great care, he takes great, when somebody's offended or something that he really loves is offended or could be hurt, he takes that a great offense, especially when he deals with the Dursleys. After, like, he finds out what they've been doing to Harry and stuff like that, and he just, like, breaks the rifle that Dursley had to defend himself and stuff like that, and he gives, Dudley the tail and stuff like that, and or like, when he bellows at Dursley, at Dursley about the when he disrespects Dumbledore's name, and you think like, oh my god, he's gonna kill him, and then, but he's also such a gentle soul because he gets so upset when something like when Norbert is taken away from him, and he starts crying and everything like that, and he becomes a blubbering mess. It takes the three of them to calm him down and such, and it's just like one of those things that it really helped define the world and help those characters express a different thing. Otherwise, that they couldn't done with other characters,
right? But by the way, in the book, when they're transporting Norbert to the tower to get picked up by all of Charlie's friends as they visit him in Romania,
right?
That was actually one of my favorite parts of the book because of how like, oh my god, this is actually kind of intense,
yes,
for these kids to be out of bed this late, and also how Ron is like, Ron was got bit by Norbert, correct?
I believe so. He definitely got nicked by him.
Yeah, to the point where his hand, like, exploded, or, like, it would turn, it swelled up.
It swelled up, yeah.
Yeah, it was one of my favorite parts of the book, and then it's like, oh my god, you're so stupid to forget the invisibility cloak on top of the tower.
Yep.
Which, as you're reading it, you don't pick it up until they're, like, until.
Yes. Who catches
Filch.
Them? Filch.
Filch pops out, it's like, we are in trouble, aren't we? And Harry and Hermione realized the cloak was on top of the tower.
And that's how the chapter ends. And it's just like one of those things that, like, without Hagrid, it feel like that story would be missing something.
Yeah, well, that scene definitely puts them in the forest. It serves the plot tremendously.
Yes.
But it does put them in detention. Malfoy and Neville feeling like he was being lied to, and they're trying to say, no, 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 you weren't. It was the truth. But.
Oh, Neville.
I know. Let's talk about Neville.
I was
like, you said Neville. I actually think it's really funny because it was something that I had very much overlooked the first few times I have reread this book. But the boat that takes them over, it's Harry, Ron, Hermione, and Neville. And you start to realize that Neville has always been this important character. He's always been right there, right on the sideline of the action. And he just, as the story goes on, and I love that about Neville, because that's another one that's a lovable oaf. You really can't hate Neville. He's always forgetting things. He lost his toad. They didn't even think he had magic. His uncle's like trying to throw him out of a window to get any kind of magical response out of this kid.
Without him, Harry would not discover his possibilities with Quidditch.
Yeah.
So we need Neville for that.
Yeah, Neville is just, Neville's like the catalyst for a lot of stuff that happens, and he's an unsung hero right up until the very end. And, you know, it's kind of fun to think about how this kid who can't keep track of anything, even the thing that's there to help him remember things he can't keep track of, he's just crucial. If you don't have Neville, you don't have Harry Potter. So.
It's funny because there's a YouTube page called Film Theory where they kind of like to become really analytical about certain things and like theories that could be happen. And one of the earliest videos they did was that Harry Potter is not the chosen one. Neville is. They have the same birthday. They have a lot of the same background. And the possibility is that maybe Harry was not the real true chosen one, since he came from a true wizarding background. At least he grew up with that. And Neville had the chance to destroy one of the Horcruxes at the end. What were you about to say, Dakota?
They did address this in the book.
Did they?
Yeah, Harry brought it up to Dumbledore, and Dumbledore was like, well, we're two of you, and Voldemort saw the Potters more of a threat than the Longbottoms.
Yeah,
making Harry the chosen one.
Right.
Because if Voldemort went after the Longbottoms, then the book series would be Neville Longbottom.
Right.
That's not as catchy as Harry Potter.
It's true. But they, and he said Bellatrix after. But,
well, once they destroyed, once Voldemort destroyed, Bellatrix was now in charge, and she wanted revenge. So then she and a bunch of people went after the Longbottoms and tortured them to insanity.
Right.
Which, very dark shit.
And you feel so bad for Neville.
Oh my god! It's like when Dumbledore brings it up, it's like, you never asked Neville why he lives with his grandmother, and Harry's like, we are such horrible people. It's like,
But it's you get take it to the fact that with this book, like not being able to remember anything and needing to remember all and stuff like that, losing his toad and being like he's introduced in a crisis. Like, have you seen my toad? And it's like, no, please just get out of our cart right now.
Yeah, and he shows up before Hermione shows up, and Hermione's asking the same questions Neville did. It is kind of interesting when you first read the book and you think, why the hell was Neville in Gryffindor?
Whacking people with microphones to help.
As the series goes on, it's like he didn't deserve to be in like Hufflepuff, because I mean, not no offense to people who like want to be in Hufflepuff, which I don't know if you really want to be.
My sister, that's her house.
Oh, I'm sorry. But
lost one fan already.
I mean, how? how Neville starts to stand up for himself in the Sorcerer's Stone. He stands up to Ron, Harry, and Hermione from going out to completely lose all the points.
Yeah.
Be like, you're breaking rules. We can't keep doing this. And then it continues to evolve to the point where it's like, oh my God, Neville has some balls.
Yes.
And especially with him. I mean, if you notice, I mean, completely another book, in Order of the Phoenix, it was Harry and Neville in the last stand before the rest of the Order of Phoenix showed up.
Yes, they were the last two ones that were.
Neville had big ass lips at the time because he got jinxed.
Right,
but it was the only two last people standing were Neville and Harry, he's always there,
and that's why. And if I remember correctly, he stands up to Voldemort in the very end of the Deathly Hallows before Harry Potter comes back from the grave, if I remember correctly. And you said you had a theory.
I have a theory on houses. I actually took a philosophy of Harry Potter course, which was the hardest course. Everybody always thinks it was like a joke course, that easy A's at the worst movies. Amazing. It was awesome. Most work I've ever had to do. But one of the things was whether or not sorting, if you're born into a house or if you become into a house. And I always felt that you had both. You're going to have a major house, which is the one that you're going to be sorted into, but you're going to have the characteristics of another house. So that's why you look at Hermione. Hermione has all the qualities of Ravenclaw. She would have done great in Ravenclaw.
True.
But she's a true and true Gryffindor. You look at Harry, who theoretically had this other person in him who was Slytherin by far and large, but he was a Gryffindor. You have Neville, who really, I think Neville probably would have even flourished more in Hufflepuff. I think he was, you know, another, like, lesser Gryffindor you didn't pay much attention to, but you realize you made a mistake.
He was the fifth beetle in that situation right
there.
Yeah,
and that's, I do think everybody has a little bit of two houses. Like, if I was to sort myself, I'd be Gryffindor with an underlying Ravenclaw. And it's just, you know, Hufflepuffs are so misunderstood. Hufflepuffs are that house that they are the smartest. They're the ones that actually study. They're not like Ravenclaws who can argue their way out of a paper bag. They do the work. They're there. They're loyal. They're putting in the time, and nobody ever gives them the credit. So yeah, like I do think.
Yeah, sorry. I think you're trying to argue in between.
I don't think you're wrong by saying, oh, like it's a wonder why Neville wasn't in Hufflepuff. But yeah, he definitely had that Gryffindor in him. He always will.
I never thought about that, but yes, Hufflepuff are probably the hardest working people, because just to get noticed as well, but they have to do all the work for them to excel. Yeah. But I mean, you look at who came out of Hufflepuff, and the first person you automatically pop to into the series is Cedric Diggory.
Yes.
And he was the compass of, this guy's a good wizard.
Yes.
He worked hard. He's not as proficient in some areas as some other people, but he's
great,
a hard worker.
Stick.
He's very talented in sports. He's very talented with magic and problem solving, and he's a cool character, and then he gets killed. But that's a different book. We keep jumping out of
it's
Sorcerer's Stone.
It's very hard not to once you've read all of them.
And he sparkled in sunlight in a different book series.
He did. There are parallels to Twilight. I don't appreciate Twilight nearly like a fraction as much as I appreciate Harry Potter, but it's fun to see a character that was casted in Harry Potter to be casted in Twilight, because I definitely think Stephanie Meyer took some J.K. Rowling.
That's probably like every author probably did that at that point.
Oh, yeah.
Upon seeing the response of the Harry Potter, I always find it funny. I was rewatching scenes of it on YouTube, and you know that scene where Cedric in the movies that he tells Harry, go up to one of the girls' bathrooms and open your egg underwater. And he's just so awkward about it. Like, go up to the, like, the fourth floor and open your egg underwater. See what it says. Yeah.
Well, I can't imagine you go.
And like, is that was that his? I always think, was that his audition scene for Twilight right there? Because he was just so stiff right there. And I'm like, no wonder he got the job as that. So I'm just like, oh man. I was just saying with Neville that, as we've said before, that he's really glued to the two. Like he, it almost seems like. Everyone, like, it's like, of course, the book series is called Harry Potter and it has his two friends, but, like, Neville, without his certain qualities, a lot of the stories would not happen. Like, for the fact that Sirius gets into Gryffindor at one point in Prison of Azkaban, because Neville was not there. And then dealing with, like, the three, like, of course, we're going out of the books right now, like, later on in the books, that we learn about the three curses and stuff like that, that he's the one like who tells, like who's prior, the Curse of Curse, and he's just talking about like what it does to people and such, and then it's one of those things that you look back, when you take it into the context of the rest of the series and you look back to how he started, you feel really bad for him. It's like, I'm like, and you kind of want to say to all the other characters, like, don't treat him like, it's like one of those people like you see, like, and you may have made fun of earlier on when you're younger, and then you see him years later and they're so much more successful or whatever, and you're like, damn, I shouldn't have made fun of that person.
I was going to say that too. Like in Romeo and Michelle's high school reunion, it's like the kid that everybody picked on ended up inventing like tennis glue or something ridiculous and like was a billionaire, but everybody had picked on him and you're like, oh crap, could have been nicer. And that's what I feel like, everybody to Neville could have been nicer.
Yeah.
Sorry, I just keep thinking, like, some things just go back. Have you guys ever read through the live Twitter read? It's on BuzzFeed. This guy live tweeted his way through all the Harry Potter series.
No.
It is hysterical what mm-hmm. he writes. But here's a section where he's making fun of Neville. And he goes, like, I wonder what the hell this guy looks like. And he throws a picture of Neville from, the most recent. It's like, and all before it was like wood for wood, and then hashtag wood for Neville.
Because
he's a short, small, fat kid, and then all of a sudden he's like, oh my god.
I love that thank God the actor turned out really good looking, because that just further goes into our point about Neville being an unsung character. Because who would have thought, out of all of those characters casted in Harry Potter, that Neville would be the hot one?
It's, I love that a meme, a guy eating sewer, like, yeah, he'll never look good looking at the picture from the first movie, and then now he spits out his cereal as his reaction. I'm like, that's pretty much how it is. You look at, like, if the original trio now, Emma Watson is obviously the best looking of the three of them. And I'm just saying, like Daniel Radcliffe just looks like this weird gangly dude now. And I'm just like, whenever you see him with long hair, I'm just like, ugh, what? He's a strange looking person
Victor
now.
Frankenstein.
I'm just like looking at the posters, I'm like,
I'll take them, but I mean, that's a different perspective.
I mean, they all had, for some reason, they decided to cast everyone with long hair in the fourth movie, which was like, this is the dumbest thing I've ever seen.
I hate that. That made sense to me.
Why? Because in the next movie, they all had short hair.
Well, that annoyed me. They should have kept.
Had like big helmet hair that covered their ears. It's like, you guys all visited the same barber or something?
We had a deal with Lego and Head and Shoulders at the same time, so of course we grew out our hair to go with this.
I'm not wearing a helmet for Quidditch. I have one with my stylish hair.
It's the entire Gryffindor house where they go to bed. Just
Osseo hairspray. I'm ready for the day.
Let's move on. Because we could talk like another 2 hours with the characters. Let's try and narrow it down with, like, let's talk about the main antagonist of book number one, Professor Quirrell.
Oh, you totally led me off there.
What do you thought I was going to say?
Snape.
Well, I was going to say.
Quirrell was stuck in there. I mean, it's obviously Voldemort is the main antagonist of the whole series, but
But Snape tries to save him.
Yes, he doesn't make Harry's life easy.
But
he's kind of like an anti-hero that's like
bad.
But no, he's an anti-hero that really was like, really, if given the option, he would say, fuck it, I'm killing you.
But yeah, but also the fact that he respects Dumbledore's wishes that, and he knows that Dumbledore will break off slack for him, and he says, like, no, this kid needs to learn something. So that's why he's tough with him, trying to get an effect of, like that, what was it, in, I believe, Order of the Phoenix, when he's saying, like, he has to train his mind, that he doesn't sugarcoat it, he doesn't go in easy for him, he doesn't pull any punches, because right. He knows he has the ability for it, but sure, if I was in that position, I would have hated him, but yeah. In retrospect, he was doing the right thing.
Well, obviously, yes.
It's retrospective thinking.
Yes, no, I hear you on that, where he is not sugarcoating the fact that Harry gets away with everything, but he does play favorites, too.
Of course.
He lets Draco get away with everything.
Of course.
But, I mean, I would say Snape in the first... Snape is the main antagonist for mostly every
He's believed
book.
To be the antagonist of the first book, anyway.
Yeah, but, so I would say that stick with him as the main antagonist, right, and Quirrell just sneaks in there.
All right, and your feelings on Snape, then?
I love Snape. He's such a great character. You just love...
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to make a face.
Yes?
No, you can finish your thought. I'll...
Yeah, keep your comments to yourself until you get the mic back.
I mean, I love him because you love to hate him. He's just a bastard, and you just kind of wonder, when the hell is he going to snap and just kill literally everyone in that school?
When's Snape going to snap? Is that what you're trying to say?
Snape.
Severus Snape. Dumbledore! Okay.
All right. But the way they J.K. Rowling is just I love how she wrote every single character. Just putting it out there, just how he's just this greasy, dark figure that just like you, just this guy looks like he belongs in a dungeon. He's almost like a Gollum, but without the obsession.
Yes, and it's like with Snape, that like he obviously singles out Potter in the very first class.
Yes,
and
but I did read a theory about that.
Yes,
he was speaking in code to say, "I really, I'm sorry about the loss of your parents."
Yes, because all the three things that he, if you put them together, yeah. Do something.
My heart cries for the loss of your
and
mother.
I wish I could bring him back, but I can't.
Yeah, pretty much. But it doesn't stop him from being a dick.
No, not at all. I mean, like...
Mr. Potter. Our new celebrity.
I love the fact that, like, we can't separate Alan Rickman's performance with it. But it's also, like, you can't cast Hans Gruber as Snape. You're gonna get...
Mr. Potter, we can talk about men's fashion all day, but I have a class to run.
I have a wand now. Ho, ho, ho. I have a cauldron now. What'd you say to me, Popper?
You would have
been... Expelliarmus, motherfucker. That may be the quote of the podcast right there.
Be sitting on a beach collecting 20%
of galleons. Anyway, I'm taking the mic away from us because we're just going to miss.
I'm stopping you. You know what? I will agree that J.K. Rowling wrote every character perfectly. I do like how she shaped them. Fun little sidebars that I really thought Professor Snape's name was Professor Shape up until the first movie release. I don't know how I misread it, but I really thought that was his name. But no, I do not love Professor Snape. And and I still even, I don't care what his motives were. I don't like how he went around them. Because when you think about it, these are kids. How he acts in a class. If this was a teacher in any school in America... You best believe he'd be fired like lickety-split. The way he acts, I don't think he was speaking in code. I didn't read that theory, but I don't think his motives were sincere. I think if he could bring back Lily and give up Harry, would.
They said that.
Is that what they said?
When he was doing the whole memory thing, when Harry was reading the memories and everything like that, after Lily would die and everything like that, Dumbledore going on. It's like, so you're saying Voldemort could have just killed James and killed Harry. If he left Lily, you'd be perfectly fine. And Snape was like, yeah, I don't give a shit about them. I care about Lily. Which, that makes no sense because Harry now knows this, and yet he still names one of his kids with Severus. But that's a whole different theory because because
we'll be there for 3 hours talking about that. It's going to be a long podcast when we get to Deathly Hallows.
But yeah, I don't
longer than the two-part movies.
I don't respect Snape. I just never could. I don't like that character. I never liked that character. I don't care if he was really trying to protect him, because I feel like everything he was trying to do, it was like, I could protect you. I'm just going to make sure you feel a little pain first. I'm gonna protect you. I'm just going to make sure... I'm just going to make you feel like an asshole in front of everybody else in your school year. You know, I loved your mother, so I have a right to torture you now because you're the reason she's dead. I don't. And yeah, his description is perfect. Like, you definitely could see somebody who's like this greasy, like, pale figure, like, trying to get that Defense Against the Dark Arts thing. And I do like that they're always like, oh, we won't let him have it. It's too close to home. But yeah, I just can't. That's the one character. I don't... Like, I almost want to say I hate Snape more than Voldemort, but I feel like I don't. I feel like they're, like, par for me.
I honestly hate Snape more than, than Voldemort. But, like I said, I
Because at least Voldemort's honest about his intentions.
Yeah. Voldemort's a badass. I'm sorry. Some moments, like, oh my god, this guy's so fucked up. It's awesome.
And I love... But, I think probably my favorite moments of the movies is the showdown between Dumbledore and Snape and Voldemort at the Ministry of Magic, and they're both their powers being equal as well. So I think it's Ralph Fiennes' performance is what really sells it for me.
Yeah, well, honestly, I know he did overplay some moments, like, I can now touch you. It's like, oh,
I think he needed to overplay it. It's such a big character. I feel like that's something in order, and I don't think any other actor could have quite captured the essence of evil like Ralph did. But yeah, I think for Voldemort,
I'm just thinking of Christoph Waltz now, like Inglourious Basterds, like Save the Jew Hunter was Voldemort.
That would kind of actually be hysterical.
I get to touch Aldo the Apache.
You know, you're right. Voldemort is at least honest with his intention. Voldemort wants to live. Voldemort wants to rule. Voldemort doesn't care who he has to step on to do it. And that's a lot more straightforward than, you know, Snape and his conflicted views.
I mean, we are way off, but...
Yeah. No, might as well.
I mean, but, like, how... I mean, one of the things that he's constantly called throughout all the books up until the sixth one, where it's like, oh, Snape, you're such a coward, and you play behind the scenes, and blah, 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 blah. And he finally, in the sixth book, when Harry's like, you're a coward, get back here. And Snape's like, I am not a coward. You don't know what I've been through. It's like, and then when you read about it in the seventh book, it's like, holy shit, this guy is like the cog to everything.
Yes.
I mean, I respect Snape. But I still hate his guts, and I still don't get why Harry ended up liking him. Yeah. I hated him for all those years, and then it's like, oh, he wanted to bang my mother, and he didn't care if I lived or die. Oh, he's not a bad person.
It's like if Frodo named one of his kids Smeagol afterwards or something like that. It's like really
Smeagol.
No.
Like I said, we should probably do the book 7 review and then the epilogue review.
just on its own. Like, as we were saying, like, Snape is very vindictive, and he's just really, really... I don't want to use the word petulant or something like that. He just seems such a bitchy person towards Potter and the people he surrounds himself with. And it's not even like... He doesn't pick on Fred and George as much. He does. He doesn't pick on anybody else in Gryffindor's house. He just picks on them normally. But just because of the fact that Potter associates with Ron and Hermione, he takes an equal amount of pleasure in being a dick towards them. And he's... Despite the like good intentions, as we like, it's later on highlighted, it's just one of those things that, like, you can tell it's a story that was not... It was like J.K. Rowling had the major plot points figured out.
Yes.
But everything else in between was obviously definitely written on the fly. You look at how many stories is like, oh, it's an ongoing series. You think the characters' intentions are different, are same in one book, but different in another. It kind of shows, like, all right, characters are growing in different situations, but it's also like these things are kind of just going on the fly, and it's like, well, hopefully nobody really notices that things are a little changing or something like that. Because Snape, it definitely seems, at least in the first book, that he was not a good person at all. He just seems like just like the asshole teacher that everybody has to deal with. It doesn't seem like he's Dumbledore's right-hand man behind the scenes that are running. He's not the Wizard of Oz at that point, just running everything from behind a curtain. But you're going to say, Dakota?
I always wondered how Snape treated Hufflepuff and Ravenclaw.
Yeah, probably about the same.
Maybe not as much because of the natural hatred between Slytherin and Gryffindor, but I could still see him being a bitch to the two other houses.
Because he probably sees them inferior in Slytherin's eyes.
Well, that's Slytherin was above all else for him. I think Hufflepuffs weren't even a blimp. I think he probably like just ignored them. Like they're probably like the kids that like raised their hand for a question and he just like didn't care. Yeah, and then the Ravenclaws he probably was just harsher on because they're the ones that were probably picking it up pretty quickly. But he didn't want to acknowledge that. He wanted the Slytherins to shine. So I do think that was like a bypass. And you know my whole thing with Snape is I never found that he was a good person, because even when you're like, oh, like evil people fall in love, like it's not unheard of. You
Eva Braun, Hitler, just saying.
Yeah, I was gonna say, I didn't know if that was like too extreme to bring like Hitler into comparison to Severus
Snape.
It's
the internet. Hitler is always brought up somewhere.
Yeah. But that's what it is. Like, I mean, evil people fall in love and they're gonna do dumb things for love just like everybody else, but that doesn't mean they're good people. And yeah, like Snape had it rough growing up and all that stuff, but you look at, I mean, if you turn around and you compare Snape to Neville, like Neville had an awful freaking childhood, and Neville just had a pure heart, and I just don't think Snape had that.
I'm just thinking now, I want to like take all like the big scenes of like Snape about his backstory and put I would do anything for love underneath it, just to see how
anything for love, but I won't do that.
Point to Harriet. Oh man, I mean. Going back to like we were saying, that like, I know we're totally off topic when it comes to Sorcerer's Stone, but I think the idea is that like he would totally kill James and Harry just to get to Lily. And it's obviously like, it's not like, even if he did that, hypothetical situation, you think Lily is going to go with him? Yeah. Like, you just murdered the two people I cared about most on this earth, and now I'm supposed to fall in love with you?
Whoop. Well, this is also the same guy that, after calling her a mudblood, he slept outside of the Gryffindor Tower just to see Lily, just to apologize.
Yes.
He's not...
He's conflicted,
He's
obviously.
He's conflicted, yeah, and for some reason he just sees, oh, the way James Potter treated him.
Yeah.
It's like, yeah, this deserves hate. This deserves the definition of hate, because James was a dick.
He hazed him really hard.
My God, he was bullying to like the extreme. This is like what causes some people to go off the rails and stab people.
Yeah. He
I mean, he came up with a curse to slice James up.
Yes. The one that he wrote down in his diary.
My lisp is not going to let me say this, but it's like Sekhsemtra or something.
That Harry uses on Draco really quick.
Sekhsemtra.
Thank you.
I would never have remembered that.
What was it again?
Sekhsemtra.
2 points for you. For Gryffindor.
And 0.5 points for Nikki.
But, as we were saying.
Lisp life.
Hashtag lisp life. But he doesn't end up using it on James, does he?
No.
Okay.
Yeah, I think he probably may have used it on a pillow or something, and it's like, oh, shit. This is a little bit too extreme.
Anyway.
But, yeah, no.
And then you feel like you have more to say about Snape.
No, I could talk about Snape forever, but, yeah.
Let's go on to Quirrell. Professor Quirrell. I know it's a little harsh to say it as somebody with, like, a stutter. It's like, son of a... bitch.
I mean, I don't think everyone in the first book, Quirrell was the least attended to.
And I think that's the point of it.
I mean,
he's so unassuming.
He was so under the radar.
Nobody suspected him.
No, he was like categorized almost as Flitwick or Professor Binns. You just didn't know who these people were.
Yeah.
He was just some weird professor with a stuttering habit and a turban. That's it. And he smelled like garlic. That's all you knew about him. And then just Snape was bullying him. Why was Snape bullying him? Because you think that Snape's trying to get the stone.
Yeah.
Snape being Snape. Snaper's
gonna
Snape.
Snape is gonna
Snape. You know,
I'll tell you, it's what I do.
Well,
Snape for... Snaping. From... Snape Snape. Oh, man.
So hard to stay serious.
I'm gonna fall asleep to Die Hard tonight. I'm just gonna chuckle to what's of myself now.
Yeah, from one, you know, speech impediment to another, I always kind of, like, felt for Quirrell, and then all of a sudden you're like, oh, crap. I just, you know, I was feeling empathetic for the Dark Lord.
I mean, the stutter
was to throw people. Yeah, and that's why, like, so the whole book, I'm like, this poor professor, he just has a stutter, he's just trying to say words, like, he's really scared, he had all these traumatic things happen to him in the forest, and you turn out, like, oh, yeah, traumatic, like, the Dark Lord's soul is in the back of his head, but, I do think they left him unattended because you were supposed to be caught off guard. That was like that plot twist. And I think when you think about it, this is a kid's book. So it was supposed to be a plot twist that, you know, a kid could handle. So if they had super developed Quirrell and like tried to go complete left field, like, just kidding, this is Voldemort, like, it would have thrown you off.
Like if they developed him like they did Lupin, and then all of a sudden Lupin was had fucking in Voldemort's face growing out of his head, that would have been like, what? But it was, I mean, that would be a horrible
I had to choose a werewolf. This is so uncomfortable when he transforms. My face grows twice.
Fleas. I have fleas crawling into my weird nostrils right now.
And I can't itch my nose.
Maybe my forked tongue will get it.
You seem like you have more to say on him, Nikki.
What? Say that one more time?
You seem like you have more to say about Quirrell.
No. I think I actually was kind of done with that. You know, I just, like I said, I think for, if you take a demographic like 11-year-olds that are reading this book, I mean, even like I was fifth grade reading this, I think it's just the right amount of evil to start you off on this series. Like, I like that Voldemort's character grows as the series goes on, and it's not thrown... you know he's as evil can come, but you don't know how evil. You don't know his backstory. You don't... You know, that first chapter of, what's his freaking... Goblet of Fire, when you go to the Riddle House. Like, you start to learn these things, and I don't think, had they put that in book one, you would get these fans that grew with the series. I think it would have been too much. It would have turned people off, because that... It was just enough to be like, there's a second book. Let me go check this out.
Right. And your feelings on Quirrell, Dakota?
I mean,
It's just like, other than, like, the few defining things, like you said, it was just like he was... Just that until the final chapter.
Yeah, it was just that, and it's just like, oh, I feel bad for him, because what does he have to offer to Snape? Because we don't know anything about him.
Right.
What does Snape know that we don't know?
And it feels like nobody takes him seriously. Not even the students take him too seriously.
Because he plays up the fact that he's seen so much, and it scared the living hell out of him. Like, they said that, like, in one thing where something was as innocent as, like, a cat just jumps up on a table, like, he freaked the hell out.
Right.
In the wizarding world, a cat could be a person. So, like, if a cat jumps on a table, you know, it could be Professor McGonagall. So you just don't know in the wizarding world.
It makes you, like, question any plant, any creature, anything coming at you. It's a terrifying place now when you come to that. It was slight realization about it. Now, with Quirrell, the one thing I noticed, like, does he shake Harry's hand in the first chapter? No. He does refuse not to touch him because he knows.
No, he doesn't know, but he refuses to touch him.
Right.
It was one thing where, in the movie, they show Harry extend his hand and he just goes up.
Like, I'm like, yes.
Because even when the sorting ceremony's over, Harry thinks it's Snape looking at him, but it's actually Snape and Quirrell.
Yeah.
And Harry's scar.
The back of Quirrell's head was
looking at him. Yeah. So, like, Harry's scar went off. So if he had touched Harry, I think it would have, like, Harry would have had an instant reaction.
Right.
And then that would have been too soon. So it's good that he didn't.
Right. And I'm just kind of thinking now, like, if he touched him, I'm trying to think, like, you know, like, Lord of the Rings, when Gandalf's about to touch the ring for the first time, and you see the iris. Yeah, I'm just like, it's like that kind of moment. Just like, just the scar. Full fight.
His hand would burn, and then you would have Dumbledore hand from the sixth book.
It's a black hand of shivers.
Can you have your other hand? No, it's the only chance. Oh, man. We're going to hell.
Oh, God.
Oh, man. Oh, jeez. Anyway, so Quirrell, like, and I love the fact that when we see him at the end, right in front of the mirror, and he turns to face him, and the stutter is completely gone, and he has this very accusation, he accuses Potter of what he's done, to the great dark Lord Voldemort that's growing in the back of his head.
Yeah. And then you see Voldemort trying to work his magic of, which we find out in later books, how he can manipulate people with just the right words.
Yes.
It's like you, and he was playing on the whole fact that he doesn't have family. So it's like you and me can get the stone together. You could help revive me, and together we can use the stone's power to bring back your family, which is what you always wanted.
Yeah,
and it's like, damn,
best villain plots are like the hero and the villain want the same thing, but just probably for different intentions.
Yeah, and Harry is legitimately like,
oh. He considers it, and he's just like,
oh shit,
how many times it's just like. Villains just like take my hand and trust me and we'll go through this and it'll be fine. Just help me out with help me help you situation.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. I had a thought and then it went away.
It must have been
an earth-shattering thought. Yeah, whatever.
All right. Now let's talk about our favorite moments of the book and why they've stuck out with us to this day. What?
Should we talk about Quidditch?
Well, this could fall under the factor of like your favorite, like unless you want to talk about Quidditch in its own right.
I think it deserves to be talked about. All right, about
then there, since right. You brought the idea to the table, you open it up.
Okay, so
as my leg falls asleep.
For those who don't know, Quidditch is a sport where there's three goals, a keeper on each end, which is a goalie, two beaters, which hit the set of balls called the bludgers, which fly around and try to get people, bludgeon people.
Yes.
The quaffle, which three chasers pretty much play around with to score on the goals to get past the keeper. And then you have the seeker, who goes after the snitch, which is this tiny walnut, golden walnut that flies around, which is very hard to see. And the game's not over until the snitch is captured.
Yes.
It works well in the book. I'll just leave that, like, just in the book, it's great. It gets you involved. It's like, this is a new element of this whole world, because like, where can this sport of Quidditch go?
Yeah.
And like, what other sports do wizards have that muggles don't have, which is never addressed, but
it's almost like a one and only thing, kind of.
Yeah, but it serves in the book so well, because there's some things where it's like Harry's like brave and strong and stuff like that, but he's not the best at anything, except he's naturally a natural born flyer.
Yeah.
And this is how he is, and it kind of then transforms him throughout the series, where he's kind of a jock at sometimes, where it's like, this is his goal, and this is part of what he does.
Right.
And he kind of can be a douchebag because of it.
It's because I feel like Harry is defined for the most part of the books as Harry, Ron, and Hermione. They threw them together almost as their own identity.
Mm-hmm.
Quidditch is one of those things that it's him.
Yeah, and it's him, but he's also not the boy that lived in that situation either.
He's
part of
the
Harry
team.
The Seeker.
Yeah.
Which is, I think, and it helps shape his character throughout the series, so I feel like it is actually something that's very important to the book series.
Yet the movies, sadly, could not translate as much as they could in comparison to how the storytellers
could be.
Well,
they completely cut it out in the fourth movie.
Which is really unfortunate.
Which is unfortunate, because there was a huge plot worked around the whole World Cup.
Yes.
But
oh, God.
Once again, that's for a different show.
No, I think you needed a sport. I think in order for people to connect, I mean, it's just like sporting in the Muggle world. You know, sports bring people together. It doesn't matter what economic status you are. It doesn't matter, you know, where you're from. It's just a matter of, hey, we like this sport. We can talk about it. You can talk with complete strangers about it. So I do think, and because that's even one of the first questions Ron asks Harry, like, oh, what's your Quidditch team? And Harry's just like, huh? But, you know, even Harry just naturally fit. And it's funny because I remember reading, it was like, oh, Dudley's really good at hitting things, but only when he could catch Harry, who was naturally fast. So it's funny that he's fast on land, and then he gets in the air and he's even better. And it's kind of fun to see people play Quidditch, like, in real life outside of these books.
I saw one time I went to visit Genesee and I saw people, and and it was funny because, like, Frost Weagle, we're doing this road hockey broadcast there, so we're just, like, trying to find the hockey arena. We see people playing Quidditch on the ground, and we're like,
they take it very seriously.
Yeah, I will admit, a few jokes were made because of at their expense.
I
will admit that.
I haven't had the honor to witness a Quidditch.
Witness.
I mean,
sorry.
They make it's like ultimate. It's almost they made their own ultimate frisbee league of Quidditch.
Yeah.
I don't know how the Bludgers or the Snitch works, but
from what I understand, like I haven't played it. From what I understand, it's like you have like a certain amount of points. Like you have to do a certain amount of running in order to as the seeker in order to count that. And I think more the Bludgeons more like use just like an extra set of chasers. Like I don't think they actually use those particular characters.
It's got like a bunch of dodgeballs.
Imagine
just,
like
just pegging people
shit
with them
at each other.
And then like the other set of Bludgers have to deflect the dodgeballs being hurled at the chasers.
Yeah,
I mean that could be cool. But yeah, no, it just I feel like Quidditch was a very important part, and it's always central to the story that it's sometimes overlooked.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the movies it doesn't really matter because some of the worst acting takes place in those Quidditch matches. But.
Well, you gotta admit, they're young kids and they're in front of a green screen for probably for hours on end.
No. The first movie, the Quidditch matches were shot up in the air.
Oh,
that
okay.
That was real. They actually put Daniel Radcliffe 20 feet in the air to shoot his scenes, which most of his scenes were just him on a broom going, "Rrr," and "Ha," and, okay, Harry, Daniel, whatever the fuck your name is, emote happiness. Ah, okay.
Which
okay.
is something
now,
he struggles with as
now,
an actor.
Yeah. Now emote anger, like you've just seen something horrible. Urgh. Good. Okay.
Now hands down. Put out your hand, ready for some balls. I mean, a ball.
Like you're going to catch a frisbee. That's just like. Urgh. Okay. Now emote, like what I taught you. Yes. No.
So do you had like these fantasies of being like in Radcliffe's shoes, shooting these scenes?
I had fantasies of the director being like an idiot when it comes to the scenes.
Yeah, it was really planned out. Like you had that really like nailed down. So like I really think you've done that before.
Just drive to work. Like, ooh, this is gonna be so good. I'm stuck in traffic.
But they are, and they're you know they're very little experienced child actors too. So like,
I just popped to my mind the captain of the Slytherin team in the movie. He has these horrible fake teeth, and he just looks just... And then when he speaks, it's just like, this is the most angriest kid you ever meet. Take that side! Oh my god, sure.
Walk this way.
And he clubs wood at one point in the movie. It's like, in the movie, it just makes it all like... this
farce of it.
Yeah.
But also, you like, going on the actors in the first movie, you went back and rewatched the first movie.
Oh my god. I can sum up the movie in 3 seconds. Or a minute.
If you know. That's a 57-second difference. Which one of them?
Okay, it's a minute.
Okay.
The movie is literally paced like, you're a wizard, Harry. Oh, look, the green guys. Okay, on the train. Here we go. My name's Ron Weasley. How many games? Let's go sorting. Blah, 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 blah. Voldemort. Oh, my God. Stone still done. Everyone's dead. Dumbledore favoritism at the end.
Bump, 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 bump.
That's the movie. It's so horribly paced to the point it's like, I need a drink because this is
Man, I think is why I like Chamber of Secrets the most, because I think it's better paced than the first one.
It's so much better
paced. And the third movie is definitely, even though it cuts out a lot.
It doesn't cut out a lot. It just throws the book into a blender and they just decide to piece it back whenever.
Yeah, but that's also Alfonso Cuarón's, like, he got Rowling's blessing to do that.
Yes, but anyway. We're going to talk about the movie some other time. But
yeah. About Quidditch.
Are we going back to Quidditch?
All right, let's talk about the broomsticks itself and with Harry's relationship with broomsticks. Well, especially, let's talk about at least the first book, anyway.
That's a hard one to throw me onto. Well, I was just going to say I really love Oliver Wood's character, but they,
wood
like...
Wood for wood.
Wood for wood. Hashtag Wood Lives Matter.
I think it's kind of good that Harry took straight to flying. I think he had to take straight to something because I think he really would have just been really discouraged and set behind everybody, especially because it's different being a muggle born and coming into magic. Everybody kind of expects you to have a little bit of a lag. But for him, who's one of the most famous wizarding kids, to kind of be behind the draw, I don't think it would have been good. So it's kind of nice that they're like, hey, we never let first years play, but you know, you're special. So
there's that favoritism right there again.
I mean that whole sequence with the flying lessons, the book handled it so much better than the movie did. But with Neville losing his remember all, Malfoy going up and saying, "Oh, I got this asshole's ball," and
this is a, I got her. Plus, I got this asshole's blood right here.
No. Did you see that idiot's face when he fell on his fat ass? That's something that's like as close to a line as it. Yeah. Get here, Malfoy. Oh, it's so much. So great direction. but no, the whole sequence with the flying thing and where Malfoy was actually like, you could see he was stunned because he kind of knows that Harry's kind of really like deer in the headlights when it comes to the Wizarding World and how he just takes to flying like a pig in mud almost. Yeah. And it's just like he's written like, oh my God, Malfoy was like shocked to see this. Okay, so it's like, okay, well,
Who's claims to spend years working on his flying skills.
Like, yeah, he's an amazing flyer and everything like that. So he hurls the Remember All and Harry chases it and in a 20-foot dive pulls out. And then it's like, Harry's like, oh my God, I did it. And then you see McGonagall coming across and he's like, oh no. And then she's just like so angry that she has no words. And she's just, follow me. And it's like, well, I'll see you guys later. Womp womp. And he follows him and she goes into one of the classrooms and says, I need wood. And he's like, oh, she's going to beat me with a log or something. And then Wood comes out and it's like, who are you?
You're not a log.
Who are you? And then she explains, and then like, oh, he caught that tiny ball like in a 20-foot dive to the ground. It was amazing. And he's like, oh my God, that sounds amazing. He's sizing him up and everything. It's such a good scene in the book.
Yes.
And the one thing about the movie they really didn't do, Wood was 15 years old and they describe it as kind of like burly and brawn.
Yeah,
and
yeah. They
wood
had like,
in the wood in the movie was
like a twig.
Okay. You just kind of got any Irish guy to play this, didn't you?
That's true.
Just pick somebody out of a crowd. But that goes back to McGonagall and the rule following, because here's someone who's very strict, very much follows rules, but broke it for Harry. So, like, I think that's kind of why, like, I like her character opposed to another rule follower like Umbridge. Like, you know, there's something there, and I think that just goes back to the sports being like an icebreaker. Because had Harry not had Quidditch, I don't think he would have taken to so many friends, if that makes sense. Like, not that he was like, you know, Mr. Popularity. He has his moments, especially throughout the series. He's totally secluded, but I think he needed that separation from the trio because even too much of a good thing is a bad thing. So he needed that individuality.
But it also kind of validates people's sayings about him. Like, because everybody said, like, oh, he's the one who lived. He's the one to stop the Dark Lord. Yet he's kind of an idiot when it comes to everything else. Yet he put him on a broom. It kind of validates the assumptions that people have of Harry having great skill. And like I said, like you guys said, first year being on the Quidditch team, that does not happen normally. And how he takes it like a fish to water and just immediately become so connected to it. And it's one of those things that, like, throughout the rest of the books, that he just becomes so intertwined with him, and especially with the rest of the plots are going, that, like I was saying, like with Hagrid, like if Quidditch was not part of the Harry Potter series in general, something would have been missing. If it was not there, and you're like, I don't know, something's, you wish there was something else that could define him but now that we have Quidditch and we have his Nimbus 2000 in the first book, which Dumbledore bought for him, is that correct?
McGonagall.
Okay. And
which was another great scene in the book where he receives the broom and the note says, "Don't open this at the table, Professor McGonagall."
Right.
He's running out the room and Draco Malfoy and Crabbe and Goyle stop him and like, "What? You have a broom? This is, you're going to get in so much trouble." And Professor Flitwick walks by and like, "Professor, Harry's got a broom." And Professor Flitwick goes, "Yes, Professor McGonagall has told us about the arrangements." And Draco Malfoy was going like,
"Ah!" And Professor Flitwick's like, "I have so much shit to do today. It takes me longer to get across the castle than you, okay?"
And then Harry looks at Malfoy like, "Damn, it feels good to be a gangster."
And flew out of there. All right, now let's go to your favorite parts of this book, Dakota. Since it's pointed at you. Alright, you want me to come back to you?
No, don't come back to me.
Jesus, is nobody prepared
for... I said my favorite parts. The whole when Harry discovers his flying ability and the whole lead up to the Quidditch thing.
Okay.
I mean, the Quidditch match itself wasn't my favorite part of the book, but the whole lead up to, like, oh my God, Harry just discovered that he's actually good at something and he's not completely out of his element with it coming, because it's coming all natural to him. And it's like one of those things where it's like, for me, growing up, it's like, okay, well, I don't know what I'm good at, but something, when you find something that you're actually talented at, you stick to it, and that's what defines you.
Right.
And it builds your confidence, and you just feel like you fit in all of a sudden with everyone else who has something going for them.
Right. And it's like one of those things, especially with me when I was growing up, I always had problems with certain classes, but if I knew I was good at it, I excelled in. Like, I loved history, so I excelled that. And I enjoyed English. I did okay with, like, science. I was like, all right, same thing with math. But the certain subjects that I really enjoyed, I put forth the effort. That's where I ended up, because it's like you were saying, you know what's good for you, or at least you find something that really comes to define you. You're just like, all right, I'm going to run with this.
Yeah, well, for me, it was when I found out I was above average at, like, drawing and cartooning and all that stuff, where I could actually, like, now go home, draw things that some people can't even do stick figures.
Right.
So it's like one of those things.
I can barely do stick figures.
Yeah, so it's like one of those things where it's like, oh, my God, I have this place to go and be me and everything like that. It's a release from everything that's going on. And in Harry Potter, that was Quidditch for Harry. It was one of those things when once he steps on the broom, he's in his own world, this is what he's focused on. So for me, those were my favorite parts of the book, because it's like I can totally connect to the feeling of what Harry's going through with this, I'm in a whole different world. This is what I'm meant to do.
Right.
I mean, I'm not drawing for a living, but it's still one of my favorite hobbies to do, just to get a break from everything else.
Mm-hmm. And Nikki?
Gosh, my if I had to absolutely pick a favorite part, it probably does have to be that moment with Dumbledore and Harry in the mirror. And you know, the cliche, it does not dwell to live on dreams and forget to live. I like that when Harry is lied to by Dumbledore, it's always in really clever ways, because he says, oh, like, Professor, what do you see? And he's like, oh, I see myself with some socks. You know, I just keep getting books for presents. So for me, like, the fact that Dumbledore is just freaking clever. Like, he's one of those people that, like, he Jedi mind tricks you. Like, you want to know one answer and you get something completely different. And I can tell you my least favorite part of the book, too.
Well, let's do the round table of the good later. Parts, and then we'll get to the least favorite parts. well, who put you in charge? Because I'm clever, that's why. Thanks, Doctor. Probably my favorite part is the chapter in the forest when they have detention, and then the dealing with the creatures that are in there, because it's one of those things, like Voldemort, everybody talks about the forest, do not go in. And but it's also like the one thing is with this book that I noticed that Rowling was very, at least had at least a first-hand knowledge at least of the what mythologies have been presented thus far. And she uses them. She uses mystical creatures like unicorns, sphinxes, and things of that nature, goblins and trolls, but uses it in her own universe. She's like, all right, I'm going to take it, what we kind of already know. I'm not going to give too much detail, but I'm just going to drop them in, and they're going to perform this in this story. And having unicorns being this kind of pure creature that cannot be caught in certain stories, and have then that being the elixir to try to keep Voldemort alive. And in that one moment, and it may have been like part of the movie that kind of like ingrained this image to me. Like when we see Quirrell kind of just like glide around the ground and eventually just stand up.
That was a cool shot.
And then the centaurs, who had this kind of slight attitude towards humans.
Yeah, but the centaurs also gave off that I know something and I really don't want, I really cannot tell you.
Yes, and they trying their best to help him in the situation.
Well, in the book, Ferenz is the only one that's willing to help.
Yeah,
all the other like
it's just they're kind of mesmerized by the astrology at the moment.
Yeah, well, that's them pushing it everything off for them to not speak. But like the whole argument between Ferenz and Bane about like. What you're not supposed to help him.
Yes.
This is not what this is. He's supposed to. They're pretty much saying he's supposed to die by this guy. He's supposed to be killed by Voldemort. And
right.
You're messing it up.
Yes. And then he's like, it's like one of those things that like he tries. It's everybody has a certain assumption about everybody. And it seems like with these books, everybody's pushing beyond that and proving everybody wrong. Neville Longbottom being one of them. Ron being like, he's not going to achieve anything. He does. Hermione is just going to be a bookworm and that she cannot be really sociable or get along with certain other people? Does. Harry's supposed to be the chosen one. He's supposed to do great things. Does, but in his own way. Mm-hmm. He's not going to do it in anybody else's terms but himself. It's like one of those first things, like the first like breadcrumbs that kind of that's paid off later. As well as the fact that Hagrid's nervous going through the forest, and he's always been the brave person in the book thus far, and that he's arming himself when he goes into the forest, and you're like, and like, all right, this if you need help, this if you see something, when you put up the sparks, and you're like, all right, these kids are actually, they're in mortal danger going into this forest. And then you got to question the school's willing to put themselves, like, would you rather have them stretched across, like, a table with chains right now, or deal with a dangerous animal that could be killing these unicorns in the forest?
Yeah, that was a huge plot hole. Just...
Yeah, but it's also, like, and I love the fact that, like, one of my favorite jokes is, like, Draco's like, well, I'm taking Fang. Well, you can do that, but he's a bloody coward. And the Fang, who's like the giant bloodhound, and is like just a big mush compared when you really think about it. All right, so unless you guys have anything else to talk about, what best moments have you guys thought of your worst moments of the book?
After you said think about a worst moment, I have.
And it is?
Anything with the Dursleys. It's just...
It's grating.
It's so nerve. It makes you like actually angry because it's like if there are, you know that there is people like this in the world. And it's like,
totally.
And it's like, but you're given a child and you literally destroy him, and he didn't do anything wrong. It's like you are just animals, and it's like I really, if I could in the book series, I would skip over the whole Dursley thing if it didn't have a payoff.
Yeah.
I mean, even their comeuppance just seemed like not what they deserve.
Right.
I mean, Dudley getting a pigtail was the least that could happen.
It's true.
It's just, all the book series, it's just like, I understand why the Dursleys are, like, purposely like this. It's just to keep Harry, like, downtrodden, and it kind of helps to make him all sorts of pissed off later on.
Mm-hmm.
But it's just like, in real life, I mean, Aunt Petunia's sister just died, and you're now giving her...
And she's very sanctimonious about it, too, and just like...
But, I mean, going with Future Head, they were close.
Yeah.
Aunt Petunia and Petunia and Lily, they were very close as kids. And
an incredible amount of jealousy for Lily.
Oh, yeah, obviously. I mean, but it was just one of those things where it's like, your sister died, and here's your nephew, who's a baby who just lost everything, and you don't have an ounce of pity? Like, what... I don't get it. Like, it's just like you have to be an asshole. You're beyond an asshole. It's just, I mean, I don't know how to articulate how frustrating it is to read these parts for me because it's just like I don't get it.
I can agree with you because, like I'm listening to the audiobook, so I'm like, can I just skip this chapter? Can I just go? Can I just go?
Just go to the world, to the Wizarding World.
But I'm like, oh, no, it wouldn't be right if I do that. So I sit through the pain and agony that he has to deal with at the Dursley's hands. And you want to weigh in on this?
Yeah, no, it's funny. My least part actually has to do in part with the Dursleys. But I agree with you. I think it's crazy. Like, even if you have this resentment for Lily and James, it has nothing to do with Harry. Like, it to the point where Vernon didn't even know if his name was Harry. Like, so, okay, fine, you want to abandon the family before you have him. You know, that's one thing. But when you have this baby who is just... vulnerable and defenseless, and you let him basically become a toy to your own son, your own spoiled son, and I just don't understand how they saw that as okay, because it's almost like at two polar opposite extremes of how awful parents can be.
Yeah.
Because you have those parents that just raise these entitled and awful and evil children, and then you have these parents who just abuse. That's it's just flat out abuse what Harry has to go through. And you know, I mean, he's getting punished for his hair growing back. He gets like a week in the cupboard. And it's like, you know, things that he has no control of. He didn't get punished for the sweater shrinking, but being on the school roof. He's like, I have no idea how I got up there. And my least, I'm afraid of snakes. And Chamber of Secrets is awful for me. I but I'm deathly afraid of snakes. I've always, since I was
snakes.
Little.
Why did it have to be snakes?
Yeah, basically.
Very dangerous. You go first.
So, you know, when they go to the zoo and poor Harry's just having the greatest day of his life, he's not hearing about any freaking cats. He has a lemon icy and he's just over the moon. And he, you know, Vernon's pulling this Darla with the freaking snake that I hate that they're even in front of. And he's tapping the glass. And, you know, poor Harry's having a moment with this. He just connects. He's like, I understand. I get what it's like to be bred in captivity. I get why you must hate this. And then he sets the snake free. And I'm like, oh, my God, I'm so glad I'm not in that zoo right now. But, and... They punish him until summer. They leave him until summer. Over, there's no logical way, even though they know magic exists, that they... How do you explain your rationale for punishing this kid? Because he doesn't know magic exists. He has no clue that he's the reason this happened. All anyone knows is that one minute there's glass, one minute there's not, and... Freaking snake was loose in the zoo.
It's also one of those things, like having Harry grow up. Are you? How can you be constantly angry at one person? It's just, it's physically and mentally impossible to just be this pure anger at one person. Even though a person that you absolutely hate and you have to deal with like on a day to day basis, you have moments where you're both laughing and cracking jokes. But it's like impossible to literally hate someone. Just every single day and every single second. It just that's what frustrates me, because it's like, and that's like, I guess I understand, like, okay, well, they really don't want him to be a wizard or anything like that. But at the same time, it's like he had zero. There had to be some moments where it's just like, okay, we actually like, hey, how's it going?
And it's like one of those things. Just like, let's try. Like, even give just like. Despite all the horrible things in, just say like how are you doing, or just like break him off just a little bit, just to give him, so he doesn't end up just
waking up in the middle of the night and murdering you in your sleep.
Yeah, you don't want like an Amityville Horror thing to happen or something like that.
He turns it to Halloween. Harry, where's the Dursleys?
big camera move, pull out.
They are so hell-bent on him not being a wizard, you would think they would have treated him better so that he wouldn't be enticed. Like, I'm sorry, you teach your kids not to talk to strangers, and Harry just blindly goes with Hagrid. He's like, what? You brought me cake? Bye. Like, so I just think who they are as people is unfortunate, that there are people out there like this, but are really that self-centered, that set in their ways, that they don't realize that the thing they're trying to prevent, they actually encourage.
Yeah. And I know this is not like the most like one-to-one comparison, but I remember one time working at Walmart, since I worked in the toys department, so I dealt with a lot of families and stuff like that. There's one family of four, husband, wife, two kids, and the mother, I could smell the alcohol on her. And we were just like berating everybody in the family, and even the husband, who couldn't really do anything, just like that. And like all three of them just kind of shamed at that. And I'm just kind of standing there, and just like, these guys to be strong, and just going off on this rant. I'm like, I wish I could do something right here, because you're just putting all three of these people down, and you're just embarrassing them, and you just feel bad for them. And you want to do something, and you just like wish you could do something. It's kind of like one of the things that kind of came back when I was reading this. I'm like, I wish I could just stand there and just yell back at the Dursleys, like, no, just leave this kid alone. Just show him some compassion, a fraction of what you show Dudley, and you'll be fine. You will have no problems. He's never going to give you anything to be angry about. Treating him the way he is, that's why he ends up treating them a little iffy throughout the rest of the books.
Type of way. That's how he treats them.
Yeah, like he when he blows up his aunt accidentally, like,
that was deserved.
Oh, she totally deserved it. But I was just like if
March
you
had it coming,
like if she had like what a few less drinks and stuff like that, and treated him like a normal person, she would not have ended up like a balloon floating over London.
I just think
save yourself and save himself from anything, and just make him leave the room.
Yeah.
That would have been probably the best thing to do, but no, you had to sit there and take it.
Yeah.
And what was the outcome you were expecting?
Yeah, exactly.
It's like you can't blame anyone but yourself in that situation, because mm-hmm. you had the clear thing to say, get the hell out of here.
Yeah.
And everything would have been fine. Marge would not have been blown up. Harry could have went to Hogsmeade.
Yeah. Everything would have been cool.
Everything would have been fine.
And the the thing that makes me aggravated the most in this book is a theme that, or it's a thing that it's prevalent throughout the rest of the books. It's Ron and Hermione's relationship at times. Ron can be such a douche to Hermione, like making fun of the fact, like, oh, that's the reason why she doesn't have any friends, and Hermione brushes back him and she's crying, yeah. And I'm just like, and like for the longest time, I did not have that many friends, and so whenever I see like one like who person who's taken advantage of the fact that like he has friends and stuff like that, and just like. Just like, oh, I'm gonna have friends forever. I can say whatever I want to do with no repercussions. And he has that moment when he says that, and he's really mean towards Hermione. And it's like one of those things that it always comes like a shorthand throughout the rest of the books that like Ron and Hermione will immediately butt heads, yet they end up together. I guess opposites attract. I guess that's what J.K. Rowling was trying to get across. But like everything else, I really enjoy. But it's just like some of that really irked me. I'm just like, it seems like it's really contrived.
That's more like what you have a problem with Dursley series here. I mean, you have a problem with the series with that. I mean, I guess the Dursleys is the same thing with me, but never mind.
But like you were saying, like,
I was going to say it's a dumb argument because I just did the same thing. Never mind.
Right.
Well, you know what? And I see where you're coming from because there was a good period of time when like the Harry Potter books were like my best friend. Like that's who I spent like after school with. And that's why I've read like Goblet of Fire like 52 times. It's disgusting. But like,
who's counting?
Yeah, but who's counting? but no, I do think that also plays into, I think we forget, and especially because we were so young when we were reading, like, these are 11-year-olds. If you have a conversation with an 11-year-old, like, that's stuff they do. They're mean to girls.
Oh, yeah.
Boys are mean to girls, and you know what? Hermione, the way she was coming across to Ron, I could see why with Ron's personality that would peeve him.
Yeah.
Like, she would she always does press his buttons and, you know, vice versa.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, and I think he knew. I think the minute he said that, because, like, that was a rough thing to say. And, you know, you ever have those moments where you don't mean it, and you say it anyway, and then
and you immediately
the minute it came out, you're like, I'm just a douchebag. Mm-hmm. And I think that's why, from that moment forward, things change. And I do think as they grow into puberty and all that good stuff, that's why a relationship kind of developed, because I think he always kind of felt like, man, I did this wrong, let's do this right.
Yeah.
And I like them as a couple. I know it's the other way around.
You and I had that conversation.
What was the conversation?
Tim brought up, is like, oh, do you really think that Hermione and Harry should have ended up together? And I was like, no, they pretty much lose.
Not taking anything away from Ginny or anything like that.
Well, that was the whole point, because the parallels between Harry and Ginny and Lily and James were there.
Mm-hmm.
Because Lily was a redhead, Ginny's a redhead, Lily was feisty, Ginny is feisty.
Yeah.
And James and Harry are practically the same person. So they have the parallels there, but you don't question that it was contrived that Ginny and Harry are going to end up together, because you actually see the relationship happen. Because
she's always infatuated with him when she's a kid.
And they even admit it.
She's like really sheepish around him.
Yeah, and then the second book was hysterical, the fact that she could not talk around, which my sister is notorious for. Whenever she's around someone that she actually likes, she can't say a word. Yeah. Yeah, it's just the weirdest thing.
I'm 25, well, basically 25, in a committed relationship, and I'm like, oh my god, that person's so attractive. And I was like, I can't. Like, it's like a girl, I guess it's like a girl thing, like, I guess we just do that, but like, so when Ginny, like, loses her shit over Harry, I'm like, oh my god, Ginny's such a girl. And like, there's like that bond, and especially, it's harder because, you know, Ginny's one of the stronger. I mean, you have a boy hero. Like, that's Harry's the character you're following. So it's nice to have these strong female roles that are important to Harry's storyline as well. That's what makes this story so gender neutral.
Because mm-hmm.
if it was just Harry and Ron, it'd be kind of like a Hardy Boys. Like, where's the Nancy Drew? So
the Hardy Boys, two young chaps who don't forget they get to adventures. Oh, I've got a rigid clue right now.
But the whole series was building up to the Ron and Hermione. Like, it was, like, to the point, if you actually take them older and they just keep bickering like they do, it's like, oh my god, just fuck already.
Yeah, it's just like one of those things.
It's just like one of those things. But you see it coming, but you don't hate that it's coming.
No.
And the same thing with Ginny and Harry, where you see Ginny liking him, but then all of a sudden she starts dating other guys. And, yeah. kinda, and Harry's kind of like, oh. I kind of liked having a girl like that really liked me. And then he was hanging out with Cho Chang.
Yeah.
Cho Chang was just like, yes, I like you a lot, Harry, but my dead boyfriend. It's like, and Harry's like, oh, god damn it.
But it's,
you
it's
just
like,
had to bring up the dead boyfriend.
What was that in Hey Arnold, the girl he liked?
Oh,
tall. No, that's Charlie Brown.
Little redhead girl. It was a redhead too.
Yeah, I think she was a redhead as well.
I hated Hey Arnold, so I kind of admitted a lot.
But it's like she's like,
they're amazing. Not saying you are, but I mean, oh come on, we had this discussion about Doctor Who. Who would you rather have, Rose Tyler, Martha, Amy, or
we always both of us said Amy
Pond, and it's like why? She's a fiery redhead, and it's like duh.
She's like Scottish to the bone, right there. Oh, so
God, it's so hot.
This should really reveal it for Dakota throughout this entire podcast. Everybody, I hope everybody was prepared for that. But the reason why I bring up Hey Arnold is because it's like I like you, but I don't like you kind of thing.
I understand that you like me, Arnold, but
I just like you. And it's kind of like the Cho Chang thing that happened with Harry at one point.
She was still interested in him, and even in the seventh book where she comes back to fight the Battle of Hogwarts, and she's like, "Oh my God, Harry, you've been on the run, and you've been a naughty boy the entire time." And Ginny's like, "Fuck you, you fucking whore! He is my man."
Oh man, and then. Amidst the gigantic battle, there was a cat fight that stopped. Even the Death Eaters are like,
because
whoa.
It was like, okay, I need to go find the crown of Ravenclaw, and it's like, I need to go find the crown of Ravenclaw. And Cho Chang's like, I'll take you to Ravenclaw Tower, and Ginny's like, no, Luna's going, and Luna's like, okay.
That's why I like J.K. Rowling, because timing's everything, and that's why I kind of like that he went on that date. Oh my god, we're the worst with keeping on the first book.
It's supposed to be Sorcerer's Stone.
But yeah, I just like everything.
I'm going to put a question mark at the end of the episode.
Everything that awesome. J.K. Rowling does, it's the timing. It's, you know, if Harry had went on that date with Cho Chang after she had the appropriate amount of time to grieve, would he be with Cho Chang and not with Ginny? And it's just like, you know, you have those people you meet in your life, like, you know, this relationship would have worked had we met later or earlier in time. So she's just a master of being able to put reality into a fantasy series.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why, like, even there's a line in this book, and I didn't get it when I was younger, and I got it on the reread. But McGonagall's like, you know, Dumbledore, can't you do something about Harry's scar? And he's just like, well, you know, even if I could, scars are powerful in their own right. And I was just like, oh my god, like, when you think about it, Harry Potter never ceases to amaze me on the ways that it can comfort, like, any real-world situation. You think mm-hmm. about people who self-harm. Here's Dumbledore, who's, you know, naturally one of your top favorite characters, saying, like, it's okay to have these scars. Like, they mean something. They build you.
They help define you.
Yeah.
Look at his broken nose.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. Or just be like Owen Wilson and be like, no, but a lot of my box office is predicated on the fact that
or Dumbledore's birthmark that's the perfect match of the British Underground, you know?
That's true.
A scar. He has a scar, too.
Yeah. Oh, that was a scar? I thought it was a birthmark.
A scar on my left knee. Oh, look at that.
Oh, jeez. Well, now this is really revealing.
I am getting revealed.
Wait. I have a scar on my forehead. It's just right here. And
Oh,
Harry Potter?
And like, am I Alec Baldwin's delusion?
Just a real quick thing. Just getting back to the whole Sorcerer's Stone plot.
Oh, yeah. Hey, yeah.
Yeah, about that. If you really, I mean, yeah, I love how J.K. Rowling took something like the Sorcerer's Stone.
I may just say Harry Potter Part 1.
It's the part it should be. So she took the idea of the Philosopher's Stone. And for people who don't know what the Philosopher's Stone was, turned it into the Sorcerer's Stone.
Yes.
Same thing. Still based on alchemy and everything like that.
I think it was Scholastic, the one when they were reprinting it for American audiences. That's why they just changed a few things during the edit.
Yeah. But the idea of it is she took a very dark, dark concept of this item and turned it into something that's like, okay, you can understand that. But if you really, like, I mean, I'm not going to go on a huge tangent, but the show Full Metal Alchemist is a whole search for the Philosopher's Stone.
Okay.
And even, like, some stuff that I've seen on, like, PBS, like, about Isaac Newton, how he was searching for the Philosopher's Stone and everything like that. It's a dark subject because it takes a lot of horrible stuff to make such a thing, like the theories behind it.
Right.
And if you really think about, if you apply that logic to this world, it gets darker the more you think about it, which is great for an adult audience because it's like Nicholas Flamel and Dumbledore were working together to help perfect the Philosopher's Stone. So does that mean Dumbledore and Nicholas Flamel sacrificed human beings to help make the Philosopher's Stone? Because that is part of it. You need like the certain mercury that is, if I remember correctly, there's the symbol of the green lion.
Okay.
And the green lion is this form of mercury that's made of human blood.
Well,
I mean, that's where it gets dark. And someone who probably knows more about the whole alchemy thing is probably like, no, you're incorrect. This is what I remember from this Isaac Newton PBS thing. It's dark. And it's awesome how she turns it into such a great child book, but it's also that
it's predicated on really dark stuff.
It's predicated on real dark stuff, like everything in the series. She talks about all these different creatures and everything like that, and like one thing that's briefly mentioned is a kappa in the third book, like, oh, like when Harry is like can't go to Hogsmeade for the first time, he stops Lupin stops and brings him along. Oh, this is my was it Grindylow. But it's like it's similar to a kappa. So they covered a kappa, which is a water demon that's anyone brought by a water, it takes them, drowns them, and eats their soul. That's dark shit.
Yeah. And it kind of just glazes over the fact that, like, oh, yeah, there's just a part of this world.
Yeah. Oh, for your final, you're going to take on a kappa. That's what you're going to do. Oh, no biggie. I studied all about kappas. Oh, really?
And the boggart, who's going to turn into a dementor, which I've kind of mastered by this point. And it's like we're saying with the Philosopher's Stone being like as we've said before, that Dumbledore's done things in the past that he's probably not too proud of.
I mean, that
it leads people to believe that maybe, because Flamel obviously is a very selfish person who thinks he wants to live forever. That's why he makes it.
Yeah.
So he probably chose somebody that he thought was not worthy of life, willing to sacrifice him for that, or found somebody who's willing to.
They probably went to
Azkaban
for the people there. They're already
Yeah, somebody.
Because they're soulless, so they're just killing them is probably the better, what's best for them.
Right.
Now, do they go through all 12 uses of the dragon's blood? Or did
they reference that he has discovered that?
Because the only, that's why I was trying to get, like, the actual thing, but, because thinking about it, like, maybe that was one of the properties of dragon's blood, like, it took its place of the human's blood, like a, only, I mean, not to say, because Dumbledore does do dark things, and we do know that, but, I mean, that comes with age. I mean, you know, you meet anyone, that every good person has done one bad thing. Like, it's just, like, part of their storyline. So I just don't, I'm not discrediting, I mean, they very well could have, you know, Flamel could have been chopping up muggles for all we really know, but, you know,
I secretly throw shoes at nuns when they're not looking, so.
I trip people.
I mean, it doesn't take away from how great and awesome Dumbledore is.
Yeah. No.
But, I mean, like, even Albert Einstein helped create, like, the atomic bomb, which killed so many people. And
Gandalf was a very manipulative person.
Gandalf manipulated people. Dumbledore fucking manipulated everyone.
Yeah. Merlin definitely manipulated at least a little bit of King Arthur the way he wants to go.
Yeah. I haven't seen
that. We're just going down all the sorcerers right now. like especially speaking of Gandalf, like the first thing he gives to King Theoden to making him give back his strength, he gives him his sword, a weapon of war, a weapon of violence. And that's what he gives him to get his strength back, to get him in the mindset, like, oh, I need to defend myself. That's why Rohan's going to go to war with Isengard. Anyway, that's a whole other podcast. And then Justin's in the background like, which I told him while we were doing the Harry Potter podcast. He's like, I want in. So there may be one other person who may be joining us for the podcast.
You're going to hear this microphone whip around like 360 degrees, Dad.
I think I need an audio mixer just so I have multiple mic inputs going into here so I can have a few mics going at the same time.
Yeah, maybe.
It may just end up doing like that because I'm kind of feeling bad just whipping this back and forth
It's working.
Kind
of
working, yeah.
But I just feel like there's a few things we could have missed. We've missed and stuff like that, and we're whipping it back and forth like Will Smith child and stuff like that.
Oh my God.
She whipped her hair back and forth. That's all I'm saying.
Okay. Back to Potter.
Okay. Final thoughts. Would you recommend this book to people?
I have a question on your final thoughts question. Do you mean solo or as like a starter to the series? Like, would I just be like, hey, just read Sorcerer's Stone? Or am I saying like, you gotta read all the books, which automatically means you start at Sorcerer's Stone?
I mean, the series you cannot read out of order.
No, it's one of those that you need to read in order and stuff like that.
Because there's little details, like everything in Sorcerer's Stone. Everything in Sorcerer's Stone plays out.
It's not like a Sherlock Holmes story. You can pretty much pick up any. It's pretty much
it's Sherlock doing Sherlock things.
Yeah,
or
James Bond. You pick it up like he's another adventure.
When's he going to bang the chick? Yeah, and kill someone. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, but in this, it's like all those hints, especially in the final scene where Harry's asking Dumbledore those questions when he's in the hospital wing.
Yeah,
it all comes back in the seventh book, and it's like, holy crap, this.
Wait, what do you mean?
Like, he's like, the first question Harry asks him is why Voldemort came after me? And Dumbledore was like, and naturally the first question you ask me is something that I can't answer right now.
Because he's always playing mind games with him.
No, because, I mean, he explains himself. He's like, I don't know if I was right or wrong about that, but it's like, I kept it from you because you're 11 years old.
Yeah.
And how would I say, like, oh, you were the chosen one, and so that's why he killed you and your family. He tried to kill you along with your family. I mean, Harry was asking some questions, and they're all questions. Some of the questions, like, I can't answer right now, Harry. You're going to have to just wait.
Mm-hmm.
And they do play out later, and Dumbledore, in one of his more vulnerable moments, comes out saying, I'm fucked up. Mm-hmm. Flat out fucked up when you asked me these. I should have told you as soon as you asked me, but I didn't.
Right.
I mean, it's just something like that. It just, you have to read the first book to get everything. It's not like I could tell you that Prisoner of Azkaban was my favorite book and that's a book that you should start reading, but some cues from the first two won't make sense in the third book, and then you're going out of order, and it's like, well, it's a Tarantino movie.
Yeah. And as you were saying in the question before, like, as a solo book, like, if you had to read one book, would you choose this book?
Absolutely not. Like, if I was on a desert island, this is not the one out of the series I would bring. I would bring a Harry Potter book, but it would definitely not be the first one.
Which one would it be?
I'd bring Goblet of Fire. Everyone fights me on it, but Goblet of Fire is where shit goes down. That's the one that's coming with me on my desert island. I don't care how many times I read it, but this is not the book. Because it's almost kind of like when I read Girl with the Dragon Tattoo,
mm-hmm.
The first 200 pages were awful. Everybody said, just hang in there, buckle your bootstraps down, and just get through them because I promise you the book gets better. And I'm like reading it, and they're throwing all these names at it. And I'm just like, this is
all those families and stuff like that. And
you're trying to like piece it together. I'm like, this is awful. And then it's like, don't quote me exactly, it's not page 201, but like around that, and all of a sudden it gets good, and you can't put it down, you have to get to the end. So that's what happened to me with this, which is the reason why I was intrigued enough to go to Chamber of Secrets. But if this was like a different series, I don't think I would have continued on. So it was just enough to get me, I'll pick up the second. I'm kind of curious to see where it goes. But even the second, with me and my snake phobia, I was willing to keep going. So this is my least favorite of the entire series.
Really?
Yes.
Huh.
I wouldn't go as far as saying it's the least favorite of my entire series. I feel like the majority of Half-Blood Prince could be omitted. I mean, there's nothing happens in Half-Blood Prince until the very, very end. And I mean, I'm not saying...
That's probably my least favorite. Oh.
It's essential to the series, but it it's the book where the least goes down. I mean, Sorcerer's Stone, it's not as dark and it's not as gritty as the other books.
There's so much warmth in this book.
There's so much. I feel like, in my mind, the series is broken down into three different pieces. The first two books have the most warmth.
Yeah.
The third book is where it starts getting cold. And then once it hits, and the fifth book is where it goes dark.
Yes.
It just flat out goes dark, and then it doesn't come back until
the very end of Deathly Hallows.
Yeah, very end of the seventh. And I love that. I mean, I can't say I hated any of these books, but Sorcerer's Stone is definitely the leap, the diving board into the rest of the Harry Potter world. And because of how well it's written and how much interest there is, because there's so much depth and you can go in every direction with it. It's like, oh, well, what other creatures are there? And like, well, what other sports are there? What does he mean? Like, what's your Quidditch team? What does Bill do in Egypt? It goes on and on, and it's like, okay.
What's this?
Exactly.
What's this?
I get a lot of questions out of this. That doesn't make me go like, it's almost like, you know, the introduction or like a summary to a book you want to read that you just kind of skip over. Mm-hmm. Like some like famous person pen, like this is the best book ever. Everything. I'm just like, yeah, bye. And that's kind of how, you have to, you're right. If I jump straight into Chamber of Secrets, I never would have known what was going on. But because unlike other series that kind of hand walk you, the first chapter is kind of like, this is what happened last book. They don't do that in Harry Potter.
They give a paragraph each book to saying like, oh, Harry Potter's not your average boy. He's a wizard. And shit went down the previous book. Then it's like, okay, forget about those books. We're moving on. Not really forget, but like, just that's all the explanation you're going to get. I mean, but this is the book where, if you're going to read the series, you have to start here.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I would agree with you. If I'm going to be on a desert island with one Harry Potter book, it's not going to be this one. It's going to be the third one.
And mine would be the second one. It's weird. Nobody chooses Chamber of Secrets or something like that. Most people, like, I was curious enough, and I looked up lists, like, how people rank them. Mm-hmm. Chamber of Secrets are usually dead last or second to last. And I never understood why.
Because
it's a book is the villain. And it's a memory, not really.
I thought that was a good twist, though.
Yeah.
But, no, but, I mean, other books, like...
Half-Blood Prince would probably be my least favorite. Because I guess the point's made, because nothing happens until the very end.
Very end, where...
And it's just like one of those things, once you finish, you're like, all right, I want to read Deathly Hallows now.
We're going right now.
But, like, you're, like, a year and a half until the next publishing date, if that. And then, Order of the Phoenix, I thought was, like... My problems with it was very long.
That was the longest book in the series.
Yes, and I feel like it dragged unnecessary, at least some parts. But then again, it could be just the memories coming back of like me trying to race to get it done, mm-hmm. and it is me like that frustration of it, like how long it went on. It may not be the story itself. It may just be like trying to read as fast as I could. Yeah. Who knows?
Well, and you know how you mentioned like the prologue, like some chapters are like this explains everything. Yes, I would see Sorcerer's Stone as that to the rest of the series. A book series that doesn't do it right is The Lord of the Rings.
No, because
the first chapter is concerning hobbits, which is literally like 50 pages of just bullshit about hobbits. And it's just like, I don't give a flying fuck. Just get to the plot. And even when they get to the main story, it's like, get to the fucking plot. It literally takes Frodo 5 years to get his ass in gear.
I thought it was longer. I thought it was like over a decade.
It was so. I couldn't get through it.
Well, Tolkien was not an author.
No, he was an English.
He was a linguist.
Yeah.
He created a world to create his new language.
There were so many huge words in that book, and it's like, okay, I'm not the best reader here, but it's like, okay, dumb it down a little bit, please. But even then, it's like, thank God the movies exist because.
Yeah, no. What Peter Jackson, Fran Walsh, and Philippa Boyens did is made it really accessible, not just for mythology nerds. And that's also, I think, one of the things him and C.S. Lewis didn't see eye to eye, because Lewis wrote very accessible stories with the Chronicles of Narnia, but also his Christian symbolism was really on the nose when it came to with Narnia. And that's another thing with... Tolkien being a recovering Catholic, really didn't see eye to eye with.
But bringing it back to Harry Potter,
yes,
all those writings in those series do play out in the Harry Potter universe.
Yeah.
Because you could see some of the, I mean, for the longest time, I always saw a Dementor as like a Ringwraith type of creature.
Totally. Except, Aragog and Aragorn.
Exactly. It just
Shelob and Aragorn.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then like
you sorry, see, it's an argument I've had for a long time.
I mean, but like we're like she, the way J.K. Rowling just handled everything in the book, it's like okay, she talked about all these creatures, and they're so still true to the source material that she didn't change them
for the sake
too
of it.
for the sake of changing them like some other series known as Twilight.
Well, let's wrap it up before we descend down the pillar of hate.
But no, she the way she just took previous fantasy and mythology and just converted it to this very readable book.
Mm-hmm.
It's just amazing, and it's amazing how she was homeless beforehand, and then just now it's like one of the richest women in the world.
Yes. Now, I hope everybody's enjoyed this podcast and the many, many tangents that came down with Harry Potter, which I knew was going to happen, and at least Dakota and I are well aware of our tangents that we run off in a million different directions. So, if you want people to follow you, Nikki, where can they find you on social media?
Let's see. I'm on Facebook, Instagram, and Snapchat. I'm pretty sure they're all under Nikki Muggle. If not, it's Nikki Muggle 1, because I'm super original.
Dakota?
You can find me on Facebook. I'm also on Instagram, Dakota.Wiegen, and Twitter, Dakota Wiegen at, like, that's my handle. I'm not that creative. I do a bunch of reviews online. Those are posted to DeviantArt.com. I take all sorts of cartoon series, good and bad, watch them all for you. It's like pulling teeth sometimes, and then write a full-fledged review. My DeviantArt page is DW Drawings, so just find me there.
All right, and if you want to follow me, you can follow me on Twitter. On Twitter, TimothyRooney2, because some asshole took my handle. And
bastard!
Yeah, and I tried turning it to, like, a.k.a. Tim Rooney, because after doing the Jessica Jones review, because it was supposed to be a.k.a. Jessica Jones, but I was having problems with that, so I'm like, all right, fuck it, it's staying at TimothyRooney2. You can follow my YouTube page, Through the Lens Productions, where our latest short film, Halloween Reborn, is up, where myself and the two guests help create, with another short film on the way as I slowly die right now. Hopefully I'll get to finish this before I kick the bucket. So hope everybody's enjoyed this Harry Potter podcast. We'll hope we talk enough about the book itself and not just about all the extraneous things that go along with the entire series. And we'll be back soon to talk about Harry Potter and the Chamber of Secrets.
Hagrid, I need you to stop drinking for a second and get Harry. But Dumbledore, it's Nickel Shot Friday. You have a drinking problem, you fat fuck.
You should have got your nose fixed.